Hello and welcome to the Filter Free Podcast. I am your host, TJ Stevens.
Well, problematic.
Out of my left earbud.
Getting off to a banging start here, though.
Joining me, as always,
Steph Hens.
Dollar Bill Dave.
I touched myself.
I just need to clip that. Just Dave. Lead it for, I touched myself.
And Timmy C.
Goo, goo, goo.
Dave's is awesome, and he got a new hat, and it's hilarious. Are you drunk, yes or no? And it's marked on the right-hand side for both.
Time limit draws get my panties wet. I love it.
We've covered this butt wipe on a few different occasions.
Butt wipe?
You don't call people butt wipe anymore?
No. I'm not seven. Good news is I've limited the producer's amount to screw us over this, so... We're actually going to get to sing along with the songs now. You are welcome.
You got a flag for your right to party!
Pow!
Oh, and welcome to the Filter Free Podcast. I'm your host, TJ Stevens.
Stephens.
Move my beers to the correct side of the desk. Joining me, as always... Dollar Bill Dave.
Peter McPuffin.
That's right. I don't know what that means. Neither. And Timmy C.
So he's Peter. You're Paul.
I'm Paul Blake from Necessary Roughness.
I'm Mary, I guess. Peter Paul. Puff the Magic Dragon. Live by the sea.
I watched Necessary Roughness last week.
Where the hell is Hannah Lee exactly?
Frolicked in the autumn mist. Please remember to subscribe and rate this show wherever you get your podcast. We're starting a new deal this month. If you subscribe to our Patreon, we will sing to you.
We have a better deal than that, by the way.
Oh, I just made that up. Why do you have to follow the show on Twitter at FF Podcast? On Instagram. Hello, Instagram. We're live there today at Filter Free Podcast. Follow our network on Twitter at Filter Free Net for now. We are expanding our Patreon network. Some of those people we are expanding with will be hopping into the show tonight, and we will announce it here on the show. I'm excited.
Right now, in fact. Because if you're listening to this on audio, it's already happened. Poof. The Filter Free Network has now become the Wrestling and More, that's right, Ram Network. That you will get content from not just our fountain, but you will also get, as Dave mutes himself, you'll also get content from Talking Wrestling with Pond Water Dave.
What? That has
Pond Water Dave, Amy,
Dave
and
Cliff.
JD, Justin Davis. You will also get content from TNA Top 10, from T-Weave, Terry Weaver, and Andrew Hermes.
Unbelievable.
And then you will get lots of collabs. We've already started kind of teasing that through the
collabs.
We just recorded one last night. Myself.
Correct.
And
we showed up. Oh yeah, you want to tell about that?
Me and Miss Amy Vaughn, as I called her on that show, the Queen of Kentucky, just recorded the first episode of our show. It's sort of a book club, but I don't really want to call it that because it's much more involved in that. It's called Power of the Pen. Our first guest was the author of the biography of the Sheik, Brian Solomon, and he was outstanding. My daughter, very excited upstairs about it.
She's don't blame
jumping
her.
And screaming.
Every week.
It's all
great.
Good.
But you will get that. Plus, last night we kind of crashed into Pondwater Dave's show at the end, which, by the way, he had a fabulous guest last night. The Professor Nick Harrison, you would know him from TikTok. The kids love him. He's plays a lot of music.
He does.
But you will also get our normal stuff. Legends, Let's Rethink This, Footballers, Evolution of Evil, Wrestling with Commercials. We're going to have big plans for bus events now that there's three separate entities running this Patron. Lots of fun to be had. And the deal that TJ did not mention, much better than us singing to you. If you join in the month of April, First month free. First month on us. Dave's what? Paying for it.
Oh.
I got you, dog.
That makes sense. That's very kind of you.
So
that's why they call me Kind Dave.
I've literally never heard that. So last night we had a little business meeting with all the shows, and we were kind of discussing what could possibly be the next Sweet Life. Which one more thing I want to get to before we start the show, but that'll wait for a second. My daughter losing her shit. She is so excited for the Sweet Life. Possible destinations for the next one. WWE is not doing PLEs in the United States anymore for some reason. Literally the only one between now and Survivor Series is SummerSlam in Cleveland. So that's an option.
And Cleveland sucks.
Cleveland sucks. And then the other one was is All In. No, I'm sorry. That's in Wembley. All Out in Chicago was the other one.
If it's in Chicago.
If it's in Chicago.
Which it usually is, but usually has not been announced.
Right.
I love they like try to build drama to that. Like, oh, where's it going to be? Where's it going to be? It's in Chicago every year. Shut up.
It's literally been every year. So before we get started, you can't see it because of my name tag. Let's see if I can hide it. I got a little memoriam thing on my desk tonight. I'll just do this. There we go. Oh, I have to have a name? Shit. You son of a bitch. So, you're
building
our good friend, Paul Bromwell.
Who?
Who? Oh, Pauly Bees has stepped away from AFS. Of course, we all know him as the host of Saved by the Pod. And he's moving up in the job world and wanting to spend more time with his son, who's getting ready to graduate high school.
Sons.
And I couldn't be happier for Paul. He's a great dude. Wish him nothing but the best moving forward. And just wanted to say that before we start. Very happy for him. Nothing? Okay.
So, cheers.
There you go.
I've had enough of that asshole.
I'm sure you have. Well, you made him a star, as we all know.
I did. I'm star maker.
So
yeah, just prop everyone up. What's wrong with you two?
I'm too lazy. I'm a well-known low achiever.
Sweet.
So
that's why we get along.
Well, the reason for the season, we are here to watch WrestleMania 12 together.
Yeah.
So if you haven't already, pull up the Peacocks.
Pull your cocks out. 12.
Pull out them cocks. Get WrestleMania 12. If you can't figure out the math, it's WrestleMania Season 12.
XII.
It's Episode 12.
And we're going to start...
Season 12, Episode 1.
So we can start watching the show before we actually start our show, because both things will be happening. Oh. Of course, taking breaks in between to discuss what the matches we're seeing.
We're going to do real show. It's just going to be playing in the background, and we'll comment occasionally.
Yeah, we're going to talk over Duke the Drumster Drossy. So,
lots of boring shit on this. Don't worry.
Yeah. Who wants to do the countdown?
All right. So we'll do 3, 2, 1, go. And then that's when you hit play on go. So 3, 2, 1, go. It's Shawn Michaels Schuller.
The boyhood dream.
He was at a liquor store, in case you didn't know. There was a sign in the background.
And there's also bars over the windows, which is also a good sign. So
that's how he lived his life back then.
Timmy, now that we got WrestleMania 12 going, we've got we still have a show to do. So why don't you get the harpsichord ready?
Because I always have it ready.
Can I finish? This week we're going back to March 31st, 1996, and we're going to watch WrestleMania 12 right meow. This is, I left a sentence in there from last week. However, before we get to that show, let's see what was happening in your world yesterday. Let's run through some events filter free up first. Timmy, hit it.
Mm-hmm.
March 4th, stories that missed the cut. I should say that first. March 4th, Minnie Pearl, comedian and actress from the Grand Ole Opry and Hee Haw, dies at the age of 84.
She was old. She wore a tag on her hat. She was way ahead of her time.
Mm. She wrecked her speedboat. March what? 5th, Earl.
I thought it was heroin.
It was both. He was high whilst driving the speedboat. March 5th, Earl Weaver and Jim Bunning head into the Major League Baseball Hall of Fame.
Kentucky Congressman legend Jim Bunning.
Jim Bunning, that's correct. March 7th, LA Lakers point guard Magic Johnson becomes the second player ever to reach 10,000 career assists.
I forgot he came back in 95, 96.
He did.
But it was only back 32 games.
Wasn't he a player coach for a minute?
Oh, we'll get back to that. We will get back to that. Not Magic. Stupid player coaches.
I don't, of all the things, he coached LA in 94.
Okay.
There's only one player coach ever that was great. Charlie Hustle, Pete Rose.
Montreal Expos legend, Pete Rose.
Shut up.
March 10th, we head over to the People's Choice Award as Tom Hanks and Demi Moore win awards for Dramatic Motion Picture, while Tim Allen and Candace Bergen win in the TV category. Good. Timmy left. March 16th, Mike Tyson beats Frank Bruno by third-round TKO for the Heavyweight Boxing Championship of the World.
My video quit.
Who?
Video killed the radio star.
I guess
that's here comes Vader.
Here comes Vader and Jim Cornette.
How do you start this show off with a six-man tag with Vader, Bulldog, and Yoko? Or Vader, Bulldog, and Owen versus Yoko, Ahmed Johnson, and Jake the Snake? Why would you not have Vader versus Yokozuna here?
Vader's just intimidating children. March 16th, Pat Summerall marries Sherilyn Burns in Florida. By the way, Summerall here was like 67.
Burns was probably 22.
I don't think so. I know she was. It couldn't have been that egregious because they didn't mention her name. Usually they do if it's that egregious. March 18th, Apple Records releases the Beatles Anthology 2.
The Beach Boys are better than the Beatles.
It's not true at all.
Hot take here.
They're both very good. And again, it's not a hot take if you say it every week. It's very reheated by this point.
Reheated
oven lukewarm. March 20th, Eric and Lyle Menendez are found guilty for murdering their parents.
Oh, the Menendez brothers.
Tully did it.
Famously in the background of the Mark Jackson basketball card.
Yeah.
Sitting front row Madison Square Garden. March 25th, it's time for the 68th Academy Awards. Braveheart wins Best Picture. Nicolas Cage wins Best Actor for Leaving Las Vegas. And Susan Sarandon wins Best Actress for her part in Dead Man Walking.
Nick Cage was great in Leaving Las Vegas.
It's true.
Fabulous movie. Elizabeth Shue. Boobies.
Oh, she's hot.
Oh, Elizabeth Shue so hot. March 28th, Angelina Jolie, who has somehow escaped being the story in the wheelhouse for almost 3 years, gets married to Johnny Lee Miller. Fucking Tom Miller.
I don't think she's real good at the marriages.
No, she... Well, I mean, she might be really good because she's done it a lot.
Mm-hmm. Also good at the divorces. You don't get divorced.
Maybe she's like, I've made this one good enough. It's time to move on to the next one. March 29th, the Cleveland Browns have decided on a name for their franchise when they ultimately make the move to Baltimore.
The Depravens.
You're going to have to explain that.
They're depraven. Okay. They're depraved.
I thought you mixed Ravens and depressed is what I thought you did.
That young franchise has a Super Bowl before your Cincinnati.
Actually, they have two.
It's okay. We're going to win a lot more.
When? The Ravens?
I've got shitter neck going on. This is terrible.
Great.
The Ravens will win another one before Cincy wins their first.
That's
incorrect.
Joe Flacco.
Bum Wine Bob is here.
I love bum wine. March 31st, 65-year-old Clint Eastwood marries 30-year-old Dina Ruiz. See, in Las Vegas, it's a shame Anna Nicole Smith was already taken.
Do you think it made his day?
Do you? Punk?
Go ahead. Make my day.
They divorced in 2014. Almost made it. Almost
that made his day.
Almost.
Because you know what? Divorces are worth it, right?
I've been told that. Stories in the wheelhouse. March 1st, NBA legend Lenny Wilkins becomes the first coach in NBA history to reach 1,000 wins as his Atlanta Hawks beat the Cleveland Cavaliers. How's this for a score? 74-68.
Back when they played defense.
Yeah, no shit.
That's a halftime score these days.
Yeah. Let's start Wilkins' coaching legend with this. Before he coached, he played for 16 seasons, was a 9-time All-Star, and when he retired in 1975, he was second all-time in assists behind only Oscar Robertson.
Legend.
Okay. Legend. Let us also mention that his coaching career began in 1969 for the Seattle Supersonics. So you may be confused, like, well, if he retired in 75, but he played 14 years, how did he start coaching in 69? Well, he was one of the last – actually, he might have been the last player coach of the NBA. In fact, with the exception of the 1972 through 74 seasons, he coached four of his last seven seasons as a player. Strictly as a coach, his NBA career began in 1975-76 as the head coach for the Portland Trail Blazers, whom he coached the previous two seasons while also playing. As a coach, Wilkins coached for 37 seasons with the Sonics, Blazers, Cavaliers, Hawks, Raptors, and your New York Knickerbockers. His overall head coaching record is 1,332-1,155, which still puts him third all-time in coaching wins behind only Don Nelson and Greg Popovich. Wilkins also led the 78-79 Sonics to the NBA title, the only title of Wilkins' career, and he was also the only person to be named to the NBA 75th anniversary team as a player and as a coach.
Lenny Wilkins is an all-time legend when it comes to basketball.
Correct.
When he retired, he was the all-time wins leader and the all-time losses leader. In fact, Wilkins has been inducted three times into the Naismith Memorial Basketball Hall of Fame, first in 1989 as a player, then again in 1998 as a coach, and in 2010 as part of the 1992 U.S. Olympic Dream Team, for which he was an assistant coach. In 1996, Wilkins was named to the NBA 50th anniversary team. Then in 2021, he was named to the NBA 75th anniversary team.
It's pretty good.
It's not his fault he got stuck with scrubs.
He coached the Hawks, the Knicks, and the Cavs. Tim, whenever you're ready, buddy. It's all you. The floor is yours.
This guy is the ultimate compiler. He is really into compiling. He played and coached for like 5 years. He had to keep padding those stats, so might as well become a coach so no one can bench my old ass but me. He averaged like 40 minutes a game his final five seasons, please. And as a coach, he wasn't great either, obviously. Seven different coaching stints with six different teams. And the one he won with the championship with doesn't even exist anymore. He killed the team.
It's seven different coaching stints with six different teams over 37 years.
Well, be good and they'll keep you in one place. In his final year coaching, he quit halfway through the season because he couldn't hack it anymore. I'm surprised he didn't start playing himself again and try to right the ship. I'll just become a player coach again and play myself 40 minutes.
At the age of 70.
Yeah, you're a real penis.
He doesn't care. Hall of Famer. No. He's the Nolan Ryan of basketball.
Oh, jeez. Here we go again.
Wow. This penis.
Here we go again. What an idiot face. Yeah. You know what they call people like you? Pat head.
Geniuses. Geniuses.
He was so bad that all of his peers were like, we're going to put him in the Hall of Fame three times.
Okay. The dream team kind of was written itself. I could have coached them to the Olympic championship.
And you could induct a cantaloupe into the Basketball Hall of Fame, please.
A cantaloupe.
Can you?
I don't know if you heard that, but when you said you can induct a cantaloupe in the Hall of Fame, my daughter upstairs goes, what?
Yeah, exactly.
she did. So, I believe we just talked about basketball, which is technically sport ball.
Let's do this. NBA...
But today, I'm the greatest of all time.
With three. Wentz is going to run the ball. Makes a guy miss. Comes down to hit. Over the second rafter. Off the floor. Nothing but net. Through the window. Off the wall. Nothing but net.
You like that? You like that? I like that.
You got to like that, right?
Here we go. I have a score right now of 6-2 for the month of March. Dave is up. I have no idea what you guys did last week. I was not here. So
we didn't do
box score trivia.
There you go. So you,
Timmy, he didn't even listen to his own damn show. Come on.
You have to do a clean sweep.
I'm ready.
Just a tie for the month.
Are we doing baseball?
Basketball.
We're doing basketball, dummy. We just talked about Lenny Wilkins. You should pay attention to your own show.
You don't even know who Kevin Millwood is.
We list.
I know who he is.
So
Cincinnati Reds legend, Kevin Millwood.
I'm giving you first crack at this. Points per game for the 1996-97 season. Let me make sure I have the right season because I've done that before. It is 96-97. Points per game leaders. Remember, this site does top 20. So how many of the top 20 can you name? There's some doozies on here. This is a good one. Timmy's going six.
All right, let's prove it.
All right, Timmy, no pressure. You got to win it out of the gate.
Michael Jordan.
Jake Roberts got a nice ass here at 96. Michael Jordan led the league 29.6. There's one.
Shaquille O'Neal.
Shaq. No.
What? 96?
There are no Orlando Magic on this list.
So I only need two?
You need two.
No, he's got to match my six. He's got to go four.
Karl Malone, second, 27.4 of the Utah Jazz.
Hakeem Olajuwon.
Seventh, 23.2. Dave.
There is no way. How many did 20 have?
So hold on. We'll get there. I'll look it up here in a second.
So I win for the month.
He died. He probably died that year or something.
Yeah, he died for one season. I want you to hear the rest of the list. So 20th, Kevin Johnson of the Phoenix Suns. Then Damon Stoudemire, Scottie Pippen, Tim Hardaway. You ready for this name? Tom Gugliotta of the Minnesota Timberwolves.
NC State.
How did Shaq got outscored Tom Gugliotta?
Jerry Stackhouse, Vin Baker, Glenn Robinson, Purdue Boilermakers legend, Grant Hill, Reggie Miller, Gary Payton, Kendall Gill, Patrick Ewing, Allen Iverson snuck in there. Well, not snickers.
Did you say Kendall Gill?
Kendall Gill.
Damn, I never would have got that one.
Latrell Sprewell, former story on this show.
Do you know Kendall Gill is afraid of rats?
He also choked his coach. Maybe he thought P.J.R. Crossman was a rat.
No, that's Latrell Sprewell.
Are we 95-96 season, right?
96-97.
Okay, either way. What was the points per game for number 20?
20.1.
All right, Shaq in 96-97 averaged 26.2 points a game.
How many games did he play?
51.
That's why.
Yeah.
You got to play 62 to qualify.
Bullshit! He averaged more points.
I don't make the rules, Timmy.
Cheater.
Anyway, you Mitch Richmond fourth. Glenn Rice, third, 26.8. Dave, you're up. Rebounds per game. We have 20. Timmy's so pissed right now.
Four.
Dave's going four. Timmy, what do you it. Got? Here we go.
Jack ain't four. On there. FYI.
He's not.
Dennis Rodman.
Led the league with 16.1. Led the league by five.
Karl Malone.
11th. 9.9. There's two.
Dikembe Mutombo.
Second. 11.6. Bonus point if you can guess the team.
Was that when he was on Denver?
That was Atlanta.
Oh, shit.
So he should lose a point for that. You got to name an extra one.
Hakeem Olajuwon.
Hakeem Olajuwon, 17th, 9.2. That was four.
Timmy?
You said four, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so Timmy, you need five. But luckily with the NBA, you still have 16 to choose from.
But he's cheating. He's looking.
Shaq? I'm not. I looked up Shaq's stats. No, Shaq ain't on there. Only played 51 games.
Ain't one of them.
Luke Longley.
Luke Longley, Chicago Bulls legend. No. No, he's not on the list.
He probably played 52 games.
Patrick, Charles Barkley.
Vlade Divac was 20th with nine. Grant Hill, Antoine Walker, Olden Polynice. How's that one? Ronnie Cicely, Michael Smith, Dale Davis, Charles Oakley.
It's Ronnie Cicely, stupid.
Shut up. Tyrone Hill, Sean Kemp, Loy Vaught, Vin Baker, Chris Webber, Patrick Ewing, Irvin Johnson, and Anthony Mason.
Turns out Luke 20. Longley, not a great rebounder.
He was not very good at basketball.
He was a really good surfer, though.
5.6 rebounds a game in 96-97.
Timmy, do you want to take a crack at assists?
I can name two.
Two for assists per game.
All right, prove it.
Wow.
John Stockton.
Second, 10.5.
Steve Kerr.
Steve Kerr. No.
Damn it.
So I need two.
Pick him for points.
Gary Payton.
Gary Payton, the glove. 16th, 7.1.
Kevin Johnson.
Kevin Johnson. Third, 9.3.
No, that was Kelvin Johnson. That was third.
Here's the rest. Greg Anthony of the Vancouver Grizzlies. Terrell Brandon, Latrell Sprewell, Avery Johnson, Kenny Anderson, Muggsy Bogues, 7.2.
Quarterback for the Bengals?
What?
Legend. Kenny Anderson.
Oh, no, not that one. No, this two one's Super Bowl appearances. This one was actually good at sports. David Wesley, Grant Hill, Allen Iverson, Stephon Marbury, Robert Pack, Nick Van Exel, Tim Hardaway,
David Cincinnati Sotomayor. Bearcats legend, Nick Van Exel.
That's right. Rod Strickland, Jason Kidd, John Stott. Well, you got John Stott. Mark Jackson led the league 11.4. So, Dave, just to be fair, let's do one more. Let's do a fun one. Let's do free throw percentage. Top 20. How many can you name? Oh, Vader Splash. Look at that mullet on my Is that John Cone? Mike Cone? Vader's right, one.
We're going to have to take a break here. Oh, after
here's Roddy Piper.
Category. Yeah.
All right. Free throws. Three.
Wait, did you say here's Roddy Piper?
Yeah.
What is your time code?
I am at 1942, 43.
Well, I am a full minute behind you.
45.
The way my internet's working, I'm already at WrestleMania 13.
So I've got gold dust caressing paintings and whatnot here.
Yep.
Playing a bagpipe. Okay.
There you go.
So you now how he's many, I think it's three. Because I have it open in the same browser as Instagram, so I keep going back and forth. I think that's why.
Now he's playing bagpipes.
I'm a little ahead now. That's fine.
Okay.
So
three
for free throw percentage. Timmy, can you beat three?
Nah, do it.
I'm going with all white dudes.
I can, but I'm waiting.
It's not. I mean, there's a lot of them on here.
John Stockton.
John Stockton. 17th. 84.6.
Damn. Jeff Hornacek.
Third. Horny. 89.9.
Also made
guy,
no women.
The guy for Golden State.
The guy for
Steph Golden Curry, State. Yes.
Chris Mullen.
Chris Mullen, 12th, 86.4.
All right, I just named white people.
Okay.
You need four people. Timmy, I will let you pick any race you would like.
So you need four people. Timmy has to go with Asians.
All right, so Shaq's not going to be on here because he didn't qualify. He didn't play enough games.
Even if he played 150 games, he ain't going to be on this list.
Let's go. Try Steve Kerr again. He's white.
Steve Kerr. You should really stop picking guys off the bench. No, Steve.
Larry Kerr. Legend.
So here's
in 96?
96. Larry Legend. I think he was coaching in 96.
Maybe he was coaching the Pacers, wasn't he?
Yeah.
He's Lenny Wilkins.
No, 96 was coaching. Still. 96 was still. Oh, what the hell was his name? The little white dude with glasses. Damn it, I can't remember his name. I think Larry here might have been the GM of the Pacers in 96. Anyway, here's your top 20. Chris Mills, Marty Conlon, Latrell Sprewell, Sam Cassell, Steve Smith, the basketball player.
Florida State Seminole legend, Sam Cassell.
That's correct. Kevin Johnson, Mitch Richmond, Bryant Stiff.
If you say Charlie Ward, I'm going to shit a brick.
Well, congratulations on saving your shorts because I'm not going to say him. Joe Dumars, Glenn Rice, Derek Martin, Hershey Hawkins, Malik Seeley, Reggie Miller, 88%, Mario Elie, Ricky Pierce, Terrell Brandon, and Golden State Warriors legend, Mark Price, led the league at 91%. And that was box score trivia. By the way,
Price was in a lot of those.
Yeah. Before we head into the next.
Roddy Piper's beating Goldust with a trash can.
Yes. Before we head into the next story, I'm going to look up. I'm trying to find right now the match ratings for WrestleMania 12 because those are always fun to shit on.
Find out how many assists per game Steve Kerr had.
In 1996?
Yeah.
Four.
The whole season.
Yeah.
Roddy Piper just. So what's funny is this match kind of gets shit on. That's why I'm kind of curious what the star rating for this is. This is like one of my first wrestling memories. I love this fight. I love it.
Well, till it got weird with the lingerie.
Yeah, I mean it did go a little far, and to be fair, the arena part probably went too long. But like this part, I was all in as an 11-year-old. I was 11 here.
Turns out Steve Kerr not good at basketball.
No, he was. It's not before he got to the Bulls. He wasn't very good.
No, he wasn't very good. Period.
Like he was mostly off.
His best season, he averaged like 23 minutes a game.
He was mostly off the bench.
It looks like he should be mostly on the bench.
Oh wait, this show took place on the 31st, so this newsletter would be in April.
Can we talk about how dumb this match is?
I literally just praised it, and you're like, also, TJ's dreams are stupid.
They're literally...
Yeah, I think this pay-per-view, they should have ended this in the parking lot.
You think?
It was a backlot brawl. Should have ended in the parking lot. It should have been Vader versus
Roddy.
Vader versus Yoko. But the opening match of this pay-per-view should have been the British Bulldog versus future Hall of Famer Ahmed Johnson. That should have been the first match of this pay-per-view.
You guys want to hear something fun? I just found this on accident. So, do you guys, Uncensored was the week before this. Do you know which Uncensored that was?
Yeah, that was the Macho Man and Hulk Hogan versus the Alliance and Hulkamania.
The Doomsday
Cage. Everybody.
Is that the cage with three layers?
Yeah.
Yes.
With and of Zeus course as Z Gangsta.
And of course, the one match everyone remembers, the Booty Man versus DDP. So that was this was rendered wrestling in 1996. See if we can find WrestleMania.
Now we're gonna do the Bronco spot.
You've been hanging was also done around Pond Water Dave too long.
I didn't care for this port either. So he has a review for Uncensored, but not WrestleMania. That makes all the sense in the world.
Just Google WrestleMania.
I found match. So this show in the Observer Reader poll got 68.7% thumbs up, 24.8% thumbs down, 6.4% thumbs in the middle. Best match was a runaway Bret Hart versus Shawn Michaels, and then Roddy Piper versus Goldust was second. Worst match on this poll, to the surprise of no one, under Ultimate Warrior versus Hunter Hearst Helmsley.
See, I would have said Bret Hart versus Shawn Michaels.
I have no desire to ever watch a one-hour-long wrestling match. Ever.
So the first match, you guys want to guess what the star rating of the first match got?
What was the star rating for the pre-show match? The Godwins versus the Body Donnas.
One star.
I'm going to say Stone Cold a star and a half for the first match.
This should have opened the show. This is when he first became Stone Cold. Because he was the ringmaster before.
Yes, right.
He shaved his head completely. That's so how you know.
First match, Dave. Timmy says star and a half. What do you got for a guess for the
two stars?
Match? Two and a half stars.
Far too good.
For that one. The last segment we just watched didn't get stars because it didn't finish. So the next one, wow, I'm surprised by this rating. We'll get into it after the match. A little surprised by that. Wow. So
Steve Austin as the $1 million champion.
Let's head into the next story. March 8th, one of TJ's faves is released here as Fargo is released in the United States.
Never seen
the film. You've never seen Fargo?
Never seen it either.
Oh, you guys.
But I just finished season one of the TV show, and it's phenomenal. So I actually have Fargo in my queue to watch.
You need to watch the movie. The movie's fantastic. William.
It's not as good as Ricky Stenicki.
This might be William H. Macy's best performance he's ever done.
No,
he was great in Ricky Stenicki.
And Shameless.
No,
well, I meant
Ricky Stenicki.
Film performance.
He was great in Jurassic Park 3.
You know what?
He was great in Ricky Stenicki.
No one is listening to you. Have you not picked up
nobody's
great movie?
Ricky Stenicki.
It's been out.
It is great. Go check it out. It's awesome.
I can't get over Zac Efron's face with all that work he's done to it.
William H. Macy, hilarious. Well, he's got to look like one of the Von Erichs. He probably does a lot of cocaine.
He looks weird now. Looks like he made out with a garbage can. Had a plastic baby.
John Cena is hilarious in that movie, though. Very funny.
He's no Savio Vega.
So Fargo was directed by Ethan and Joel Coen and starred William H. Macy, Francis McDormand, Steve Buscemi, Harb Prisnelli, and Peter Stormare. The film was shot during 1995 and actually premiered at the 1996 Cannes Film Festival,
Joel
Coen won best... What?
It's Con.
You're Con. Won the Best Director Award while in Cannes.
It's Con!
The year is 1987, and Jerry Lundegaard, a down-and-out car dealership owner in Minnesota, suddenly has money issues, but he does have a wealthy father-in-law, so he makes a plan to have his wife kidnapped for ransom. The two kidnappers will be in charge of the ransom plot, who are Carl Showalter and Georg Grimsrud. Pretty sure I got that right. Kidnapping goes without a hitch. But on the way to the stowaway location, they're pulled over, and that's where the movie takes off. The film was shot primarily in the Minneapolis-St. Paul area, as well as Pembina County, North Dakota. The bar the pitch took place in was demolished in 2003. The dealership that Jerry owned in the movie is now the parking lot of a Best Buy headquarters. The film was shot in a $7 million budget and grossed a box office total of $60.6 million.
On review aggregator site Rotten Tomatoes, Fargo holds an approval rating of 94% based on 104 reviews with an average rating of 8.8 out of 10. That has to be one of the highest rated movies we've ever discussed here.
Dude, I'm telling you. Tremendous.
The site's critical consensus reads, violent, quirky, and darkly funny, Fargo delivers an original crime story and a wonderful performance by McDormand. Gene Siskel and Roger Ebert both declared Fargo as the best film of 1996.
They're right.
With Ebert later ranking it fourth on his list of best films of the 1990s. I wonder what their top five were.
Ricky Stenicki.
Shut up.
Yeah. Fun facts time. This is the least of the fun facts. There were no fun facts about this movie. Ugh. The actors used a book called How to Talk Minnesotan to help with their accents. They used a book to help learn the accents.
That's easy. My mom was born in Wisconsin. I can do the accent. It's not hard.
You kind of do already. It's okay.
The echoes.
Minnesota.
Take off your boots. I just vacuumed.
But here's the thing. You learned by watching. They learned by reading a book. How do you learn accents by reading a book?
You know,
up here in Minnesota.
Timmy, that snowing. Might be the best question you've ever asked on
snowing
this show.
Snowing like the Dickens, Minnesota.
Yes. Dave's got it.
You've heard people talk. Did you read a book to find that accent out?
So
head down to the
I first got Kringle. Minnesota accent. So I was at a church camp thing in New Orleans in 10th grade.
It seems like a good place to have a church camp.
So all the stuff was at the Superdome, and I met a girl, and I had her back in my hotel room.
He kissed a girl and he liked it.
What a church retreat.
And got busted by the youth pastor.
Weird.
But I always remember she was hot as fire, and I just laughed because she was from Minnesota.
Mm.
A little hot blonde number.
She said, "Oh, Dave."
Oh, oh crap.
Who'd have thunk? Oh, Dave with a blonde, huh?
Yeah, weird. That's completely off personality for you.
Who the hell has church camp at the Superdome?
So it was...
Was it was like Church of Satan?
It was like a convention thing, and it was for the Lutheran churches, and the big thing that year was in the Superdome. So it was just for kids. So it was like a team.
That's where I want to take kids is to New Orleans.
Yeah, we went down on...
Hey, look, titties everywhere.
We went down on Bourbon Street and everything. That was the first time I ever saw a transvestite. Big old
I don't think that's what they're called anymore, Dave.
What do they call them?
Transgender.
Oh, transgender. Well, they were transvestites back then. Because I'm like, wait, that girl is 7 foot tall and has a beard.
Was it George Muir?
She was standing on a box.
George... Smelled like cabbage.
Also, to be fair to his church group, nothing knocks the horny out of kids than the 1991 New Orleans Saints. So I also would have had it in the Superdome. Like, want to see how this terrible this football team is? Look at this. They're terrible.
They all had to wear bags on their heads. All right. The role of Carl Showalter was written specifically for Steve Buscemi. Yay. There's only one scene shot in a bright sunny day. Cinematographer Sir Roger Deakins, he's a damn knight, hated that it was sunny, feeling that it was against the movie's mood. It's in Minnesota.
I actually think it worked out in the movie's benefit.
Well, it's Minnesota. How'd you even find sunlight?
It's not Alaska.
3 weeks into shooting, Joel Cohen and Ethan Cohen revealed to their cast and crew that this was, in fact, not based on a true story. What?
Well.
Actors are dumb.
Wait, so they told me it was a biography piece?
Yeah, I think, yeah, this is based on a true story. Frances McDormand accidentally left her pregnancy suit in her trailer one night. The silicone breasts in the suit froze, and one of them exploded the next day on set. That is the funnest fact you'll get here, is exploding titties.
How do you know it wasn't the belly?
It said,
yeah, oh.
I don't read notes.
That's good.
You don't read your own notes most of the time. Most of the snow in this movie was artificial since it was not snowing in Minnesota when the film was shot. I always just assumed it always snowed there. What are they like the 2 weeks in June where it doesn't snow?
Yep, summer, the summer pay period,
summer Minnesota. Weeks of Minnesota.
Yeah.
March, oh, Dave.
March 9th, at the tender age of 100, comedian and actor George Burns dies from heart failure. George Burns is one of the more influential people in the history of entertainment, but due to the time of his career, this is probably the only chance we'll ever get to cover him, so that's why we're doing it here on this show. He was born...
Well, I mean, I'm sure we're going to do a show from... We're going to do NWA 1912. Wrestling from 1946.
If I can find it. We're doing it.
I will quit the show.
They didn't have television. We're not going to find that show.
And I'm going to do the whole show with this voice. He was born on January 20th, say, 1896, New York City. He was the ninth of 12 children. At a young age, Burns got a job in a local candy factory as a syrup maker at the age of six. Because it was 1902. Weirdly enough, during this job is when Burns was discovered. His first job in entertainment.
Discovered.
Discovered. Was this operating the curtains at the Vaudeville and Nickelodeon Theater of Frank Sidan? And no, that's not the Nickelodeon we know it.
Were they doing
the Nickelodeon that's gotten in trouble for raping the kids?
They were doing You Can't Do That on Television.
Oh, the producer. Yeah, I just saw that today.
I got to watch that.
Burns was then drafted into the Army during World War I. However, due to his extreme nearsightedness, he was disqualified from service.
He was a terrible shot on the musket.
Well, he was with that nearsight.
Fired the cannon.
He was probably pointing the rifle in the wrong direction. It was like going over his shoulder. His first marriage was to one of his dance partners, Hannah Siegel, and lasted an entire 26 weeks. But before we get too judgy about that one, the marriage was actually a sham. Hannah's parents would only let the two tour together if they were married first, which makes absolutely no sense. Listen.
To be fair, 26 weeks is 6 months.
That's true. But I only want you touring, dancing with my daughter if you're banging each other. Otherwise, no, sir. In the late 1920s.
Well, maybe they didn't want them banging unless they were married.
Why are they assuming they're banging? I don't understand.
Because back in those days.
That George Burns was so handsome.
That, like, I love our, like, the generations before us. Like, all you kids do is unsafe sex. Get married before children. They're like, hey, if you want to dance with my daughter, you have to marry her first.
If you want to dance with my daughter, you have to marry her first.
Was his foot loose? In the 1920s, Burns began his on-screen career in a series of short films with some minor league players like, I don't know if you've heard of these guys, Bing Crosby, W.C. Fields, Jack Benny. Burns also prospered.
What was W.C. Fields' greatest saying of all time?
I have no idea.
He made great cookies, though, or his wife did.
W.C. Fields.
Mrs. Fields.
A man's got to believe in something. I believe I'll have another beer.
That is very good.
Boom.
Very good. Burns also prospered through the avenues of radio, first for NBC for 12 years before moving on to CBS. Burns then got his first real break as a solo act when he would get the George Burns and Gracie Allen show in 1950 on CBS television.
Hey, dumbass. He would get his first real break as a solo act when he get the George Burns and Gracie Allen show. That's not a solo act. That's a duo.
I believe it's Dave's turn.
Yeah.
So you shut your pie hole.
Sorry.
So has anyone ever seen George Burns without his trusty cigar?
That's he's negative. Dead, so no.
I bet he's buried with... There's no way he's not buried with a cigar.
That's why I think it's one in his mouth right now.
It's a Cohiba.
Burns was still appearing at major hotel casinos in Las Vegas, Reno, and Lake Tahoe during the early 1980s. When Burns turned 90 in 1986, the city of Los Angeles renamed the northern end of Hamel Road George Burns Road. City regulations prohibited naming a city street after a living person, but an exception was made just for him.
They knew he was not going to be living soon. So
I mean, look at him.
Burns remained in good health for most of his life, in part thanks to his daily exercise regimen of swimming, walks, sit-ups, and push-ups. He bought new Cadillacs every year and drove until the age of 93.
I bet that was a sight, him driving at 93.
Only got
and he was 70. Really short, too, wasn't he?
Yeah, he was. He was tiny, but he only got in 71 car accidents.
I seen him. He was in Ferris Bueller's Day Off.
After that, Burns had chauffeurs drive him around. In his later years, he also had difficulty reading the fine print. He's 100. Of course he can't see.
Yeah.
Why was he reading fine print? It was like punishment to him. Here's a paper with fine print.
In July of 1994, Burns suffered a head injury after falling in his bathtub and underwent surgery to remove fluid in his skull. I remember when that happened, everybody thought he was going to die because he was literally 98 years old and fell in his bathtub. He never fully recovered, and his performing career came to an end.
In February of 95, Burns, in what was said to be his final television appearance, was presented with the very first SAG Lifetime Achievement Award by the Screen Actors Guild. When Burns was 96, he had signed a lifetime contract with Caesar's Palace in Las Vegas. I'm guessing they didn't think that one was going to last very long. To perform stand-up comedy there, which included a guarantee show of his centenary, which was in January 20th, 1996.
You misspelled that day.
It's not cemetery. It's centenary. What I said, centenaries. It's centenary.
I mean, I wasn't going to say anything.
When the day actually came, however, he was too weak to deliver the planned performance.
You think
so? Not only did they sign this contract, now they're paying him and he can't even do anything.
They sued him to get that money back. They're like, we're going to sue
Caesar's was like,
shit,
hey,
out of this 100-year-old man.
Let's just give him a contract. Look at him. He's never going to, we'll just have to pay him $9. He can't perform.
Stone Cold beat Savio Vega. Now we got a Diesel interview.
Yeah, this was, was this Diesel's last pay-per-view?
No, the next month, that Good Friends, no, that Better Enemies.
When was Cold Day in Hell?
That was that a couple like years later. That was Austin versus Undertaker.
Was it?
Yeah.
When was WrestleMania 31? Wasn't that his? He was there.
In December of 1995, a month before his 100th birthday, Burns was well enough to attend a Christmas party hosted by Frank Sinatra, who had turned 80 that month.
But that was
where he reportedly caught the flu, which weakened him further. He released a statement joking about how he would love for his 100th birthday to have a night with Sharon Stone.
I would also want that.
Yes. She's still hot.
I don't know.
She's almost 100 now.
Let's look her up.
At age 13, he charged immigrants coming in by boat from Ellis Island $5 for dance lessons. By the way, that was a lot back in 1910. It was. Telling his clients that it was a necessary prerequisite for becoming a U.S. citizen. I like this guy. George Burns.
Andy just texted me and said she was watching our podcast, but she didn't like it because she couldn't interact with us.
Try to get in the chat, bro.
Tell her.
That's what I just told her.
Use the chat.
Also, look at the table here. My Atlanta. I'm sorry. What were you saying?
Okay. George Burns has 3 stars on the Hollywood Walk of Fame, a motion picture star at 1639 Vine Street, a television star at 6510 Hollywood Boulevard, and a live performance star at 6672 Hollywood Boulevard. Burns is also a member of the Television Hall of Fame, where he and Gracie Allen were inducted in 1988.
That was from Burns,
a solo act. Burns, yeah, solo. Burns is a best-selling author who wrote 10 books. Until his death, he smoked as many as 10 cigars a day. He appeared in 17 TV shows and 41 movies. We got a bunch of compilers this week, don't we, TJ?
But George Burns and
Lenny Wilkins.
Lenny Wilkins?
Yeah.
You're an ass clown. So before we start again, Sable, here at WrestleMania 12. But let's see. You want to guess Steve Austin and Savio Vega star rating?
1.75.
Okay.
3.25.
2.
That wasn't a bad match.
No, I agree with you. So here's was his
6 stars better than Hogan Andre.
That's true. Both guys worked hard, but there was no heat, and the finish died live. The work itself was good in spots and slightly off in other spots. Of course, up next, Ultimate Warrior and Hunter Hearst Helmsley. This match.
Good news is we can watch this. Yeah.
Yeah. This one's only 1:38.
TJ, I think you should do the play-by-play. So Ultimate Warrior's fireworks have started, but he is standing
sparklers
in the entrance.
Give me a time code. I think I fell behind again.
He's running
45, 42, 43, 44, 45. He's running to the ring like a madman, and he's trying to sell comic books.
With Destrucity. My dog loves it. He's going apeshit downstairs.
I thought that was Carson.
Could be. Maybe she's probably trying to ride him.
That reminds me, need to tell her to get her shower.
You texting her?
Yeah, she has.
I really enjoy that Warrior came back to WrestleMania 12 in what appears to be a Canadian tuxedo.
It's a duster.
But it looks like it's made out of denim.
Jandy said she commented on Instagram during my New Orleans story.
What's her Instagram name?
J-Sue W? Yeah.
Yeah, she did.
I said, open up this link and we can bring you into the show. I commented on your Instagram or on Instagram during your New Orleans story, but you didn't respond. Too late. I'm naked in the shower right now.
Oh, she said, oh, really?
Hey, we're trying to pop a rating here.
Oh, about the blonde girl.
Go on and go to the link.
There's my wife hearing me talk about the blonde girl. I was in 10th grade. It was before her. It doesn't count.
So this one time I was trying to get Poon at a church group meeting in New Orleans when I was 10.
Yikes. She was from Minnesota. We used to write each other in the mail.
Ride?
Right. So, I don't know about you guys, but here at 11 years old, I could not have given less of a shit that the Ultimate Warrior was back here in 96.
I was kind of pumped for a minute.
I still don't give a shit that he was back.
I was kind of pumped for a minute, but at the next pay-per-view, he did that bullshit with Goldust, and after that, I was done.
So
I was like, this guy sucks.
Was Lawler before this or after?
Lawler was King of the Ring.
So, yeah, so he does this, Goldust, Lawler in back-to-back months.
And correct. None of them were anything.
No.
And then he, because the live show I went to, he no-showed.
Of course.
So we got Vader versus Ahmed Johnson, since it was supposed to be Warrior versus Vader.
Right.
But
Pedigree by Hunter Hearst, and no one gives a shit. Warrior's back. He hasn't even taken his duster off yet.
Oh, he's you're slow. He just hit him with the first clothesline, second clothesline, third clothesline.
Well, I just accidentally saw what's next. I'm real excited. I just saw him hit the splash, rolls him over, 2, 3. Mike Chioda says, get this shit over with.
Here's the big shoulder block.
Maybe I went too far ahead.
Yeah, I'm at 48, 58, 59, I'm 49 minutes.
I'm a full minute ahead.
He's picking him up for the gorilla press.
I'm going to just pull his penis right off.
And this is the worst finishing move ever.
It's not good.
I wonder how much they paid him for this.
Well, if I remember the story correctly, they had a finish. Of course he was going to go over, but it was going to be under some sort of dispute because they were going to try to push on her here. And just before they go out to have the match, Warrior changes the finish and threatens to hold the show up unless he gets a bigger payout. So that's cool. Glad you brought him back. Seems to be money well spent. And here's the thing.
At this point, he knew Hall and Nash were leaving.
Yes.
So he was trying to bring in somebody that could pop ratings.
But, like, imagine. I can't remember anyone in the history of wrestling be more celebrated for essentially a 2-year run than the Ultimate Warrior.
So my dog was going apeshit downstairs.
Okay.
There were kids outside. Mm-hmm. Do girls still go door-to-door selling Girl Scout cookies?
Usually they're at Lowe's or some shit outside.
Yeah, my one of the guys I work with, Bruce, brings the sheet into our office because he knows we're fat.
Apparently my dog barking at them made the little girl stick around even longer. So.
You should get a Ring doorbell. Then you can just tell her to piss off.
I told her to piss off in person.
Oh, you should just ring doorbell. You don't have to do
it. I walked down there and I said, look here, you little. All right, never mind.
You did not swear at a 9-year-old.
I didn't swear.
Okay, thank you.
I said take
Ultimate Warrior.
I would.
What kind did you get?
Mm-mm. Nope.
He bought some Samoas because he's
done ruined my show.
The chocolate peanut butter ones are the best ones.
By the way, the Samoas aren't called Samoas anymore.
Why not?
I don't know. They have a different name. They're like caramel coconut, whatever. I guess that's it's racist.
I don't ever buy Girl Scout cookies because I like Oreos better.
That's true.
And Girl Scout cookies are trash.
No, Samoas are pretty good. I hate coconut and Samoas.
That is a hot take.
Girl Scout cookies suck.
You want to guess two things here. The star rating for Ultimate Warrior and Helmsley, and also when you do want to guess Warrior's age here at WrestleMania 12.
Negative 7 stars for the rating.
And he's 36.
Okay.
I've just been informed. I've been informed Samoas are now called Caramel Delights.
Who told you that?
My lady friend. She is watching and messaged me.
The Ultimate Warrior was 38 there.
Hi, Sarah. 38?
And it got negative 1 star.
No, that's his guess.
No, he's looking it up on the interwebs.
No, it's his guess.
I said negative 7 stars.
Here, hey, Tim, I'll tell you this. He's wrong. How about that?
I'm going to say Ultimate Warrior was 41.
He was 39.
I was close.
So he wasn't wrong. He said 39.
I said 39 originally, then said
30. Your first guess was 39. Huh. And his the star rating was a dud, which is
that's what I said, negative 7 stars.
Yeah. Up next, we have Undertaker against Diesel. This is 1646.
Diesel's walking out now. I didn't mind this match. I thought it was good.
You know, Diesel takes a lot of shit. And I always say he's the lowest rating champion, lowest drawing champion. The business was in the shitter when he was the champion.
By the way, Bret Hart didn't do real good either.
No, I mean, nobody did from 1993 to 96. But I mean,
at least Diesel was good at wrestling.
I thought for being as big as he was, I thought Diesel was decent.
I did too.
Decent.
I mean, how's he supposed to really succeed when he's SummerSlam, one of the biggest shows of the year, and he's facing Mabel? Like, what are we doing here?
King of the Ring.
His match at WrestleMania 11 with Shawn Michaels was really good. The feud with Sid could have been better.
So I remember one of the episodes of Click This, he talked about this match with Undertaker. And he said he knew this, you know, was essentially it, right? We just discussed he had the In Your House after this. But Undertaker asked for Diesel here. So Diesel was like, okay, put his working boots on tonight for the Undertaker. And I don't remember this match. I remember it happening. I don't remember anything about it. So I'm actually curious to see what a working Kevin
Diesel had said that originally he was supposed to go over here till he told him that he was leaving.
Right. So I'm curious to see what a working Kevin Nash looks like. So we certainly did not see it in WCW.
No, he was very lazy in WCW.
I wouldn't say lazy. He was just always on. Like, in what scenario was he ever in a match where you're like, man, Kevin, he's really outpowered here.
Well, I mean, he tagged for the first couple of years.
And there's that.
So, and Scott did all the work.
Because he was booked in a way, even when he faced Goldberg at Starrcade, like, you thought, is the scoreboard on? It is. There was
That's for the timer for later.
That's right. The thought, there was a thought in everyone's head, like, Nash might actually do this. Of course, it went down stupid, but I mean, it wasn't outside the realm of possibility it could happen.
See, I look at Goldberg the same way I look at the Ultimate Warrior. Hot trash.
Well, again, when you go to have a match on Nitro and Lord Steven Regal takes your ass to school.
Are the Girl Scouts back?
One of them took a shit on his doorstep.
I think, Timmy, it's your turn. He's got to catch his breath.
No, I'm getting ready to beat the shit out of some kids.
He's got to catch up on his internet also. You need to pay that bill, bro.
Yeah, bro.
Now it's my turn. That means it's my turn.
Mm.
Let's go to Timmy's Trivioki.
Figaro. Figaro, 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 Figaro.
That's not Tosca.
Ugh, my ears.
My neck, my back.
Yep, I remember. Everyone remembers when Elvis performed that.
All right, March 1996, my junior year of high school, Dave. Song number one, clue number one. This is a song by R&B singer Tony Rich from his 1996 debut album, Words. Released as a debut single November 7th, 1995.
What was the artist?
It's the Tony Rich Project.
Oh, and then he was the Tony Rich Project.
Tomorrow morning, I'm going to hear the dusty roads. Going to find you wherever.
Dusty. Yep. You What's the name? Go. All you got to do is get the name.
Undo my heart and hope you come back to me.
Eventually, you're going to get to the title.
Then when the nights are lonely, days are so sad. And I just keep thinking about the love that we had. Now I'm missing you.
I think
and nobody just knows it but me. Days are so sad.
Yes!
I just keep thinking about the love that we had. Now I'm missing you. And nobody knows it but me.
By the way, Zoe Lopez on Twitter just said he equates Ultimate Warrior and Goldberg, which I think we would agree with that.
That's an insult to Goldberg, actually. Goldberg's not racist. Maybe.
That is true. Or homophobic. As far as we know.
Song number two, clue number one. This is a song by American singer Joan Osborne for her debut studio album, Relish.
Joan Osborne? Like, wait, what Relish? Like on a hot dog?
I think it's more like she's relishing that she's got an album.
I want a hot dog.
Anyway,
Joan Osborne, that was
Nope, stop. Get ready for clue number two. This was a hit around the world, topping the charts in Australia.
Just a song. Just a song. Like one of us. Just a stranger on the bus. Trying to make his way. I remember the whole scuttlebutt was she was Ozzy Osbourne's daughter back in the day.
I remember that too.
She was a very attractive lady though. Whew. First woman I ever seen with a nose ring.
Hot dogs is a popular topic right now in the chat.
Zol didn't like my singing? That's bullshit.
Why would you not like our singing?
Inappropriate, Zoe. Inappropriate.
Jen hates that song.
Yeah, that song sucked.
Whatever.
Next. 96 is prime, man. This is good music right here.
I know.
And Timmy's
all right, song number three, clue number one. This is a song by American rapper Coolio. It was the third
Gangsta's Paradise
studio album, Gangsta's Paradise. Clue number two, Larry Flick from Billboard.
One, two, three, four. Get your woman on the floor. Gonna get up, gonna get down. Gonna get up,
gonna
get
down. One, two, three, four. Get your woman.
Get your woman on the floor. Gonna get up, gonna get down. Gonna get up, get down. What up, everybody? It's Coolio.
Get your woman on the floor. Gotta get up and get down. Gotta get up and get down.
I killed this one. We should do 96 every week.
I
agree.
96 was the best year ever.
What if I pick all music? I know TJ's got no chance.
Do you know how many? I mean, I almost went with Breakfast at Tiffany's from Deep Blue Something.
I probably would have got that before Dave.
What about One Sweet Day, Boys to Men, Mariah Carey? Remember no much good stuff. Time, Hootie and the Blowfish.
Oh, How dare you skip that?
I'm going to see them this summer. They're performing in Cincinnati June 7th, I believe. I've got to get there.
You going to buy me a ticket?
Hit the clip.
No.
Oh, it's time for Dave's Fave. Have you seen it?
You slipper the hot beef injection.
We're men in tights, tight, tight. Oh, more tires. Maybe next time. Maybe before me.
I got nothing, guys.
Huh?
The score is tied 4-4.
Amy did good.
Three movies this week, and I win. All three of them are awesome.
Gotta be.
Are
they all Dave's faves?
Nope. Here we go. Movie number terrible. A, with a budget of $55 million. Our first movie this week grossed more than $122.1 million at the box office. This is an American action thriller film. When terrorists seize control of an airliner, an intelligence analyst accompanies a commando unit for a mid-air boarding operation.
Patriot Games.
This stars Kurt Russell, Halle Berry, John Leguizamo, and Steven Seagal.
Oh, geez. Whoa.
Here we go.
I'm sorry. Did you say Kurt Russell and Steven Seagal are in the same movie?
And John Leguizamo?
Yes. This is the only film I have ever seen where Steven Seagal actually dies in it. He sacrifices himself in this movie. Kurt Russell is the main character of the movie.
I have no idea.
Yeah, no, I got nothing.
Executive decision.
Never heard of it.
What? You've never seen it? You gotta
think a movie executive should have made the decision not to make that movie.
That movie is how porn begins. Kurt Russell, Halle Berry. Yeah.
Okay. Steven Seagal.
He does karate porn. Kick you in the vag.
Uses a kendo stick.
Terrible. Terrible.
Here we go. Movie number B. With a budget of $31 million. Our second movie this week grossed $37.5 million at the box office.
That ain't good.
Felt that in my nuts.
This is an American military comedy movie.
In the Army now.
Lieutenant Commander Tom Dodge is assigned as captain to the USS Stingray, an old diesel submarine that has seen better days.
Down Periscope.
Down Periscope. Lieutenant, you're almost out of uniform. There you go, TJ Steffens. With a 5-4 lead, which is going to go ahead and end the game now.
Can I tell you my favorite line? So Rob Schneider's out in the gully testing all the food, and the chef's like, I don't understand.
Did you just call it the gully?
The gully. He goes, I don't understand what the issue is. It smells galley. Like. He goes, it smells like creamed corn. He goes, it's deviled ham. Just me? Okay, that's cool. I just won't say anything anymore.
Here we go.
So many good movies in 96, and you picked these two turns.
What? Well, I picked Down March Periscope of 96. Great, bitch. Yeah, Down Periscope is awesome. Karate Bukkake. All right.
We need to start doing t-shirts again.
Karate Bukkake is a
good one. No, she'll try to get a cut of that. We don't want that one.
Well, she can get a cut of that. Here we go. Movie number C. Are you ready? With a budget of $39 million.
Ooh, it's a lot.
That was
our third movie this week. Grossed $37.9 million at the box office.
Ouch.
This is one of Dave's faves.
Of course it is. Booyah. Lost money.
This is also an American military comedy film.
God, his name like four.
The master sergeant in charge of the motor pool at Fort Baxter, a small United States Army base that develops new military technology.
In the Army now.
Nope. Exploits his position. They're water people over in Bahrain or some shit. Exploits his position and directs a number of scams ranging from gambling to renting out military vehicles. Major Colin Thorne, an officer from the U.S. Army Inspector General's office, arrives at the camp and begins to scrutinize his record and conducts a general inspection to determine if the base should remain open in light of recent defense cutbacks and to get revenge to settle an old score over a woman. This movie stars Steve Martin, Dan Aykroyd, and Phil
Sergeant
Hartman.
Bilko.
Sergeant Bilko. Sergeant Bilko. Damn it.
We're tied.
Oh, shit. Let me come up with another one.
We're tied 5-5. There's got to be a winner, except if you don't get the first one. Then we can go tight again.
Jandy says, I said, you missed me singing. She goes, I tapped out after hearing about hot blondes in your hotel room.
That's fair.
All right. So we're going to go one more movie because why not?
I like it.
Let me do some digging, talk about the match.
All right. So again, I'm impressed. So Timmy, you were beating up children, whatever it was you were doing at your house. So I was discussing on an episode of Click This, Kevin Nash was discussing this match. Again, he knew he was coming out the door. In Your House was still coming up. And but he said he was going to put on his working boots for Undertaker going out the door because Undertaker picked him for this match. And I was curious to see what a working Kevin Nash looks like. And so far, I mean, this has been a good match, especially for two giants.
Or were you expecting less with Undertaker?
And imagine the year before he's wrestling King Kong Bundy.
Well, Bundy was a dump truck. You're stealing money, Bundy.
Yeah. And he was a dump truck by that point.
Well, no, he was a moving truck. I've seen that movie.
Oh.
Richard Pryor.
We got a bear.
I gave him
here.
The wrong finger.
We got a bear hug here by Diesel on the Undertaker. Referee, one of the more glorious mullets here in you'll ever see in 1996, Jack Doan.
I don't think that. I mean, that's not a glorious mullet. It's a very terrible mullet.
That's why it's glorious to me. It's called sarcasm.
But it's not long. It's a short mullet.
Can I tell you a story about Germany?
Sure. I mean, so we got nothing else to do. So
I mean, there's still a lot of this match left.
There's
so,
there's still a lot of this pay-per-view.
Here we go. It's the tiebreaker. You ready?
Okay.
I mean, this movie came out in February.
Oh, it was probably still playing in March.
Came out in February, so it was probably still playing in March. Here we go. For the win on a budget of $50 million.
God.
This movie grossed more than $150.2 million at the box office.
Okay. Made money. Good for it.
This is a 1996 American action thriller film. Terrorists steal nuclear warheads from the U.S. military, but don't count on a pilot and park ranger spoiling their plans. This movie stars John Travolta and Christian Slater.
Broken Arrow. TJ Stevens with the win for the month.
Finally, he wins movies.
I love that movie. Howie Long is in that movie.
We're in season three, and I don't think he's won movies yet.
He won them every time I was giving them to him.
That's true. This was Zoe Lopez's guess.
Correct.
Godzilla.
Godzilla.
So I was in Germany. As you know, and I did not know this, but Germany does not understand like
English,
us, like the whole dichotomy. No, stupid. Actually, most of them speak English, but like the whole dichotomy like, between us, right? We just talk shit to each other constantly, but it's like a term of endearment. So we're in the shop, and it's me, one of the electricians I work with, and an electrical engineer. We're just talking mad shit to each other the entire time we're in the shop, and at one point, this dude, Frank, who's the engineer on the project, turned around, looks at me, and he kind of, you know, sets me off the corner. He goes, you guys picked to come on trip, yes? And I go, yeah, we were picked out of the group. And he goes, you guys know like each other? And I was like, no, we're getting along great. Why? And he's like, you're very mean. You're very mean to each other. And I was like, no. It's
just why are you making this German guy Japanese, by the way?
I'm not. And he goes, I was like, this is how we are. We just talk shit. And he goes,
Timmy, you want Jens Carson Palmer jersey?
It probably won't fit. And I already got my own. Thanks.
You can hang it up on your wall.
It will. It'll fit us.
How's the OnlyFans going, Jen?
Wow.
Free promotion.
Actually, so here's what we'll do. We want to use the t-shirt Karate Bukkake.
and we'll promote your OnlyFans.
We'll keep the cut. We'll promote your OnlyFans. How's that? By the way, that's a real thing. Not making that up. Also,
are
the
you
question,
sure?
Anyone want these Carson Palmer jerseys? The answer is no.
Only if it's an Arizona Cardinals one.
What's it, Timmy? Give us a time cue here.
No, oh, that requires me. I got 111, 43, 44.
41, 42. Undertaker's choking Diesel.
So we're
Diesel
all about
punched Undertaker. Punched Undertaker. Punched Undertaker. Okay, so the next night, Mankind made his debut.
Yes.
Who did he wrestle on Raw in his first match?
Oh, I used to know this.
96. Scotty Too Hotty.
No, 96?
He was a jobber back then.
It was an enhancement. He was. Scott
it was not an enhancement talent.
It was not enhancement talent.
Kind of, but not.
Duke the Dumpster Drosy.
Bob Sparkplug Holly.
Really?
The Undertaker wrestled
in the main event
that night.
He wrestled who?
Before, it was Bob Sparkplug Holly. The Undertaker wrestled in the main event that night before being attacked by Mankind.
Right.
Who did the Undertaker defeat in the main event of Raw that night?
See, Undertaker, here's a baby face. Heel mid card, I'm gonna guess.
Very mid card.
Okay.
Became a WWE champion.
Later on.
Yep.
Helmsley.
Justin Hawk Bradshaw.
Oh. Very good. Thank you.
Seen it live. Seen it live.
Yeah, I will say, given Kevin Nash's testimony of him putting his working boots on here, I'm digging this match. I don't agree with the star rating. We'll go over that when the match is over, but I think this is good. I enjoyed this. By the way, we're completely done with our part of the show. Now we just have the wrestling show to do. We still have an hour and 35 minutes to go, but luckily there's only the end of the Goldust Piper fight and then the main event. That's all that's left of the show.
Good. So I can stab myself in the eye.
Well, no, you're wearing eyewear, so no, you can't do that. But
I might use the eyewear.
Oh.
Just saying. We need Miss Amy here with the cards. That would be fun to do during this.
That would be fun.
Send her a message, Dave. Tell her to bring her cards.
I almost asked a really stupid question. I'm glad I didn't.
What cards?
No. Undertaker gets the win after the Tombstone. So, let's see. Final sentence of the write-up. He did it again. And then when he went for the pin, Undertaker grabbed him by the throat. Diesel used a back suplex, and Undertaker sat up again. Undertaker then finished Diesel off with a nice flying clothesline, a chokeslam, and a Tombstone. What is the star rating for
this? What?
Match? What? What happened? And in my opinion, a very good big man match. What do you think the star rating was?
Three.
Two and three quarters.
Two and a quarter.
I like this match. I dug it.
I did too.
Anyone else think Undertaker's kind of a compiler?
I will stab you in the neck with a knife.
Talking to my boy all wrong. Do it again. Stab you in the face with a soldering iron. So Dave kind of mentioned earlier that the Body Donnas and the Godwins.
Skip and Zip?
Was a pre-match or pre-show match. Actually, the Body Donnas won the tag titles in that match. It was the end of a tournament.
We already talked about this.
I'm aware. There was
Tony Khan in WWE in 96?
No. There was another pre-show match. There was two. Do you know what the other one was? And you're never going to guess it, just so you know.
Jeff Hardy versus Matt Hardy.
Nope.
as jobbers.
It's I will give you this hint. They are parodies of people.
Oh yeah, it was
Fake
Huckster and Nacho Man.
Fake,
Huckster and Nacho Man.
Nacho Man, Huckster, and Billionaire Ted. Here comes Gold Dust screaming into the arena with a. I mean, I used to have a full size Bronco.
That's not an arena. That's there he is. That's a parking lot.
This is the arena.
It's a parking lot.
Almost Roddy Piper almost committing vehicular manslaughter there, killing Gold Dust. So let's do this as well. I see that. I love this.
I'll be right back. Got to put my kid to bed.
All
right.
So, well, wait. I have the numbers here for the show. I'll wait to do that until Dave comes back.
Nah, keep going. Hey, there's Marlena.
Roddy Piper here in 96 is my shit. Like, I was a big fan of Piper. Well, as you know, because I still think the following year at Super Brawl 7, Roddy Piper should have won the world title. Should have beat Hogan. And you will not convince me otherwise.
Jen is now tweeting about the free promotion of her OnlyFans on our show. I'm thinking this OnlyFans might be a ruse. It might be like John Cena's OnlyFans.
Oh. For the record, none of us have seen it.
Maybe. Well, I'm not clicking any link Jen puts out there. There's no way. I don't know what kind of Saudi Arabian porn site I'm going to wind up at, but
all of a sudden I will be a subscriber of Reader's Digest.
Yeah. All of a sudden Sports Illustrated's up in my mentions. I'm not clicking it, Jen. Sorry.
No. Yeah. Let's look at my OnlyFans. Get a fucking rager in the middle of your show. What are we doing?
I'll give my computer Ebola.
Like, do one of these. Oh, Jen's OnlyFans is real. Excuse me for a.
And there he went. I guess it was real.
So here we go. Roddy Piper, Goldust now in the ring. I love
this story bleeding.
Of this fight. Well, no, they're actually not bleeding here. They had to recreate the end of the backlot brawl. But what is real is Roddy Piper's wrist is broken.
Yep.
Which happened from the backlot brawl. It was when he got, it was the dumpster, I think, the dumpster shot. And so he's legit trying to tape his wrist up. He had his cast taken off just before he drove into the arena. All right, Dave, now that you're back, we're going to do numbers for the show, or for WrestleMania, as soon as I scroll back. And by the way, this got no star rating because it's not a match, technically. So we had...
It is. It's a match.
No, it's a brawl.
Horse shit.
I don't make the rules, bro. I didn't write this shit. So the announced attendance on TV is 18,852. Allegedly, according to the Observer, it's actually 15,855. 12,909 paid for a gate of $737,440. Allegedly, at the time, it's the largest grossing wrestling event west of the Rocky Mountains. And that was Hogan's Slaughter from WrestleMania 7. So they did $176,000 in merchandise. I don't see pay-per-view buy rate numbers. I don't see it, which is a shame. I guess I gotta look it up.
I'm looking it up right now.
Thank you. Well, Roddy and Goldust are just beating the shit out of each other.
Like, legit beating the shit out of each other. It's
for
not
real. So, like, here, right? I don't mind this part. I think like I feel like this part still feels legit.
Okay, here we go. WrestleMania 12. Timmy C, how many buys do you think this pay-per-view got?
Let's do this.
230,000.
TJ Stepins, how many buys do you think this pay-per-view got?
I would say for the year they averaged 230, but this is WrestleMania. I'm going to go 310.
Okay, the number is between 230 and 310.
There you go.
290,000 buys.
That was close.
Yeah, price is right. Not, you lose, though.
Not great.
Price
not
is terrible. Wrong, bitch.
Not great, but not terrible for 96, I would say.
I mean, you were getting them to buy it at, what, about a $49.99?
I believe it was. Yeah, I think 50 sounds right.
$29.95 back then.
Really?
Not for Mania.
Oh, nah, because
Mania had to be more.
There was no pre-show. There was no access. There was none of that shit. Like, if you remember, WrestleMania 2000 might have been the first time they started charging 50 because they had a stream all day. So when you bought WrestleMania 2000, you had the pay-per-view all day, not just for the show. So, like, here we got Goldust beaten away. Piper's making his comeback. To me, if you skip the lingerie part and go straight to the finish, this gets a lot less hate than when it gets now. And by hate, I mean it's just not looked upon favorably. But again, I love this brawl. Especially at 11 years old. I love this a lot.
Looking it up right here, WrestleMania. Oh, that's 13. $29.95.
Terrible. I'd have charged double. Although there's a shitty Bret Hart match, able to I probably wouldn't have.
I love being able to pay $90 a year or whatever I'm paying for Peacock, $60 a year.
Apparently, Jen just got her first OnlyFans subscriber.
Sweet!
And he may or may not be in our chat.
It's Joel. Yeah. Not Joel. That's his OnlyFans name. It's Joel Lopez.
Why don't you give us that link so we can put it in the chat and maybe look at it?
Yeah, put that link in the chat, Jen.
So we got Goldust getting stripped down.
How many people get Saudi Arabian porn with Ebola?
Do you remember where Goldust said he bought his lingerie for this show?
Fredericks of Hollywood.
Yep.
No.
Fredericks of Hollywood.
Really?
Oh, no.
Uh-oh.
Oh, no.
Dave's in trouble. No.
Lane Bryant. He bought his lingerie from Lane Bryant. Oh, no. And that's a big girl's Hollywood. Hey, girl.
What's happening? I heard
hey, turn your volume down.
I heard what?
Or put your AirPods in.
I don't have AirPods.
She's
ignore
fine.
To me. Just continue.
Okay.
Echo. I heard your New Orleans story.
I know a good lawyer.
This was 20 years before I met you. Doesn't count.
Oh. Where'd everybody else go?
They're backstage.
Oh, are we supposed to duke it out?
I guess so. What's up? You want to go?
Let's do it.
What's your hotel room temperature?
Hot.
Still hot?
Yeah, I had to like sleep naked last night. It was too damn hot.
So tell them the story.
I think we should get a collab with Jen and Jandy on an OnlyFans.
We literally just plugged in OnlyFans, and then Jandy's like, I had to sleep naked in my hotel room last night.
It's a true story. I can tell you my window is open. It is freaking hot in here.
Where are you at?
New Jersey.
She's in Newark.
Newark.
Why?
No, I'm in Parsippany.
Parsippany. Same thing.
Well, just saying. For work. We had a conference.
Mm. Well, I was hoping you were going to blow New Jersey up.
I was in Germany, my hotel room was hot because I don't know centigrade.
I would have Googled it.
I turned it up to 70.
Son of a bitch, my carpet's on fire. So here's what's great, too. My first night there, I get in. Jet lag is all get out. And there's like no shower curtain. It's like it's a window on a hinge that makes the wall of your.
Oh, shower. I thought you were just like water everywhere all over the bathroom.
So the window goes in towards the faucet of the shower. So the only way you can turn the shower, unless you're just standing in the shower like a clown, is to fold the window and then reach around it like this to turn the water on. But I wasn't smart enough to do that. And I also did not look where the shower head was pointed before I turned it on. So I turn the shower on, blasts me in the face, floods my bathroom in the hotel. It's just everywhere. But here's the fun part. So I go down after that. We're getting ready to go to dinner and then, you know, go to the bar afterwards. It's Germany. And I'm telling that's like, I just got blasted in the face with my shower, which was incredibly hot as well. And I flooded my bathroom. Literally all 10 of us were like, yeah, I just did that too. So I don't know why, but all shower heads in Germany face outside. I don't know why that is.
Did you ask any of the German people why?
No.
No.
You know how to say? You say Dugenschnauzer, das Water.
That's water. It's actually das Wasser. Minne Wasser. Is that you? Bitte. Wasser bitte.
Janny tried to move us to Germany, crazy lady.
I love Germany.
I tried. He did not want to. He didn't want to do Germany or Italy.
I actually have a soccer jersey and a scarf hanging in my office now. You just can't see it. It's too far off frame.
Can't do it. I got to be near the beach.
We are not near the beach right now there, love.
What time is it in Germany?
They're 5 hours ahead. So it's, I'm sorry, they're 5 hours behind. So it's.
They're ahead.
No, you're right. They are ahead. So it's. 2 o'clock in the morning there right now.
Carla Olson. Lauren said the shower she had was like that too, TJ.
Yep, there's my soccer jersey and scarf right there.
Hey, look at that Longoria jersey.
Yeah, my
Jandy scored that in Korea for me.
What was the Dalvin Cook? His jersey's right behind it.
So. She got that in Korea too.
But did you actually buy it in Korea or did you order it from Korea?
I bought it. I went there.
Where'd you go in Korea?
All over. I went twice. So I went to all of our army installations. Mm. The first time I went north or south. The second time I went north.
I see.
And then I went shopping in Osan.
I would say South Korea is probably my top five bucket list right now.
I think it'd be I want to go. Yeah. I want to go to South Korea.
I think it'd be interesting.
I liked Okinawa better.
Oh, Japan's like number one.
Yeah.
I want to go to Japan and I want to go to Korea, but
I would say right.
I didn't love it. I mean, the shopping was fun. I'm glad I went, but like, I don't know. I guess I went for work.
Like we need to go and we need to get my uncle to take us.
Yeah. I guess if I went and enjoyed it, like not just work, it would have been okay.
I would say right now my top five, because Germany was on there. Now it's cross that off. I would say it's Japan's number one. London and Toronto have been up there for a long time for me.
We were going to go to London a couple years ago. We were going to go to the Bucks game in London.
Yeah.
And it got announced and we started looking at getting tickets to go to the Bucks game. And my sister says, okay, guys, I'm engaged. The wedding was the same weekend as we were going to be in London.
Wow.
Brood. So we canceled all plans for London, and a month later, she and her fiance broke up.
Whore.
That's not funny, but it's kind of funny. Ridiculous. So here comes the boyhood dream ziplining from the top of the arena.
Come true.
So, honey, this match we're getting ready to watch is like an hour and 2 minutes long.
That sounds terrible.
Yeah, so I think you and I should go FaceTime or something because this sounds horrible and I don't want to watch this crap.
Well, what's fun is all of the new members of our Patreon network said they were going to run in tonight. None of them have. So that's
did
fun.
You pull this one up about Bunwai Bob driving?
Yeah, I drove through Persephone today. Go figure.
But
she also has an OnlyFans.
Who, Bunwai?
Persephone.
Oh, that's a whatever. So Japan, London, Tokyo, Ireland.
Kathy,
we're going to Ireland soon.
And five's tough. I don't know if I want to do Brazil or New Zealand.
Ooh,
that one's tough.
My dad lived in Brazil for 3 years.
Did he really?
Yeah.
Why?
Because he lived in London.
There, right?
Yeah, he lived in London for 2 years and did the Y2K project in London.
Cocaine farmer.
And then he moved to Brazil for 3 years because he lived in Sao Paulo.
He likes to tell me the story before he learned how to speak Portuguese. He and a coworker went to a pizza restaurant one night, get pizza. Couldn't talk to the waiter because the waiter only spoke Portuguese. So he tried to draw a pizza because he wanted mushrooms on his pizza. And he was trying to draw mushrooms, and the guy looked at him like he was
crazy. Why are you drawing a dick, sir?
He thought he was drawing dicks on the pizza.
The guys
looking at him like,
kitchen were having a great time that night.
We don't have tube steak pizza, sir. Can you please put that down?
He wants nut all over his pizza. That's fine.
So I think we need to do a family trip, all of us, to Japan.
Germany. Yeah.
I would love to go back to Germany. I told you, so I hated soccer. And I told you after going to a German Bundesliga soccer game, I would go back just to watch a soccer game. That shit is crazy.
We might go to one.
We're going to try and see one.
We're going to try and go to one when we go to Ireland. I got to get with Adam O'Neill. He's supposed to be hooking us up. So he just got tickets to the football game.
Nice.
Maybe we'll
get sitting. Lucky. He's sitting right beside us in the section right next to us.
Nice.
At the game. He texted me the other day.
And they'll book like a triple threat football game between the Bucks, the Bears, and the Bengals in Frankfurt.
In August?
I'd go.
Maybe.
In August. So it's preseason. So we went to a German Bundesliga game, and in the 70s, Mönchengladbach, which is the name of the town I was in,
bless you,
they were like the shit in soccer. Not so much now, but they were playing their biggest rival when I was there. So the crowd, they do chants the entire game. It's intense.
I do that in my living room watching Florida State.
I've seen it actually.
TJ, what do they say when they chant? Like, is it like nice chants or like are they being bullies or what?
Oh no, there was a lot.
They're in German. He doesn't know.
There was a lot of this in the chants because so it's like college football. The opposing team has their own section, but here's the difference: it's surrounded in plexiglass, and there's also SWAT cops all the way up the stairs on both sides. And so
soccer. This blows my mind. That is
it's crazy.
Fucking worst sport ever.
So
it is the most popular sport in the entire world, except for here.
It's stupid. So
the opposing team would win. I'm sorry. The opposing team would score a goal, and all of a sudden, the away team's colors were red and white. There'd be red road flares going off in the opposing team. Now we had the suite package. And we got patted down getting the stadium. I'm like,
the suite life.
Well, it wasn't kind of, I mean, it's a lounge you get to go to in between, like before the game, in between, and then the end. But we looked at the guy that brought us. His name was Matthias. And I go, Matthias, they patted us down. How'd they get those road flares in? He goes, trying to figure out how you say in America,
Keister.
In butt. And I go,
what? They keistered him.
So I'm hoping, I told my buddy Chris who was there with me, like, I hope they put the flare end down, right?
That's why they bring their ladies with them.
And they scored three times, and every time, road flares are going up. And then
that's crazy.
The home teams, by the way, the game ended in a tie, 3-3. So then the home team
scores. That's disappointing.
Yeah. The home team scores. And then I look over in the home section, there's fucking smoke grenades going off. What is going on in here?
Those are a lot bigger than road flares. We got problems here.
They have very large butts in Germany, apparently.
Good thing they didn't have. Remember that we did the soccer story? And like,
oh, yes. The
like 100 people died.
Yeah, they got trampled. Yeah.
Yeah. Too bad that didn't happen while you were
there. They put them in plexiglass. And they also have their own separate entrance.
Well,
that blows my mind.
This stadium was much more sturdy than that one, I'm pretty sure.
It didn't fall apart while we were there. So,
oh, yes, and here's my favorite part. We're walking into the stadium. And by the way, 54,700 people were there, sold out.
Was that how many tickets were sold or how many people were there?
Yes.
And so, were they inflated?
The people inflated? I don't think so.
Yes, with road flares and smoke grenades.
Oh, that's right. So we're walking up, it's kind of a weave around, and also you walk by all the team stores and stuff to get into the stadium, and there's a sapling, a tree sapling. Couldn't be that big around. And then there's just in the grass, right? Only tree for miles out there. And there's a guy, and there's like a bicycle rail fence that guides you where you're supposed to walk. There's one guy just pissing in front of that tree. It's daylight.
Should have been pissing on the tree.
It's daylight, by the way. And then I look to see on the other side of where he's pissing is the stadium. And there's people just walking around, and he's just just dick out to the entire stadium. Like, I had to go now.
Was it something he should have been proud of, or no?
I didn't run around and be like,
Let me see it.
The German stereotypes are wrong. You guys are hung. Congratulations. High five. Actually,
you are the superior race. Shit.
Don't high five me. That's, I need hand sanitizer.
Give him a low one.
You could sword fight.
Just give him a quick little.
Play Dingo Wars.
I don't like this story anymore.
So, Jandy, how's New Jersey? Anyone peeing on a tree? Well, there are lots of people peeing on trees.
She didn't sleep last night. She's tired.
I'm very tired. I learned that turn signals are super optional here.
That's about 42 of the states.
You really don't have to have adequate space when switching lanes. What?
They just come in. She got to the airport yesterday.
I don't have good internet.
She had to wait for an hour to get her rental car. And they told her, okay, we have an electric car. And she goes, okay, well, how does that work?
I did.
They said, well, you have to bring it back fully charged. Cord. They said, you have to bring it back fully charged. She's like, where do I charge it?
Isn't that kind of impossible to bring it back fully charged?
They said it takes like 2 hours to charge it.
Driving there, you're going to use charge.
I don't think. All right,
we're going to give you a Tesla. Here's your D cell battery. Better be charged when you bring it.
Her internet died.
Well, she's in a Motel 6, so
that New Jersey shitternet.
I doubt she's in a Motel 6.
Wait for her to come back.
By the way, you want to hear the best part of the Germany trip? I got to claim those miles on United. And on the way back was business class. What's up?
Wow. So now we're in minute one of 60 of this match, so we can talk about something else now.
We've got a ways here. So what do y'all want to talk about? The Bears just signed traded for Mike Evans.
Or not? The Bengals have The Bengals have the largest duo of tackles, offensive tackles, ever in the NFL.
We need a center real bad.
Oh, Jen wants to know what you're going to do with those miles.
I haven't decided. Maybe that maybe might pay for the Japan trip.
Should use them on our OnlyFans. You can pay in miles there.
Well, I mean, I'm in then. My wife won't find out. My wife can see my bank account, so I can't do it that way.
There you go. What do you do? I'm paying in United miles.
Who the fuck? Who are you following on OnlyFans? Like, oh, this girl, she needed help for college. I felt
bad. 25 years ago.
That's a dick thing to say. Oh, you guys are going to love the star rating for this one.
Bengals have that. Oh, we can also talk about the Bengals having two players that had children born on the same day this week.
Okay.
Evan McPherson, our all-world kicker, and Logan Wilson, our all-world linebacker. Both had children same day.
Maybe it was a foursome.
I don't think so. That's weird. Would be weird. That's some Tampa Bay shit.
Imagine being the kid and finding out.
Oh, now we got the scoreboard. We're 4.5 minutes in.
It's so cool that you're my dad. Well, actually, that guy's dad. Oh, we got a run in finally. Andrew Hermas is here.
Can we get a better one? Can we find a better run in?
It was a slow walk in for those of you playing along at home. It was not a run in.
We see your figure.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I don't regularly use your restaurant, though. I hear that's bad for you. Lots of
questions. No, no. Ice cream machine always working, baby.
I believe
that doesn't make it good for you.
I didn't say it was good for you. By the way, we've divided this up because of our Powerball pot that we have going. The right side of the screen is going to be the riches, and the left side of the screen is going to be the poors because they didn't join in.
Well, see, what makes me happy is you did that in the middle while I was doing my thing called a job, so I couldn't answer you. And then
you don't have your phone?
And I spend no money.
I was busy doing electrical things.
Yeah.
Can I read you guys a headline? I want your thoughts on it. I kind of know Dave's because he replied to it.
Oh, my God. 54, 13, 12, 11. I can't sit here for 54 more minutes.
You're going to.
So here, let's turn on basketball and come back to this.
Let's get your thoughts on this headline. Oregon man arrested and accused of grabbing women's feet and rubbing them on his face.
Yeah, I commented on that on Twitter today.
Doesn't surprise me a damn bit.
Well, it's Oregon for one thing, and that's the Wild West these days.
That is correct. I've never been to Oregon, but I've been to Washington State twice, and I was stationed there for 3 months.
How is he getting people? How is he grabbing women's feet? I mean, just the mechanics of that crime.
With his hands.
There's a lot going on.
That's what I'm saying. It's just the mechanics of it in itself.
Yeah. I mean, that's a lot. I wonder if he's going to like strip clubs and just when they're walking by on the stage, he's just sneaking away and like, ah.
No, their heels are way too high.
And then, the shoe show.
Although 42 strippers have broken their ankles in Oregon this year because he keeps grabbing them and knocking them over.
I was going to say, the fact that you know that.
I had the same thought, but my thought was more safety. Like, why the fuck are so many strippers breaking their ankles?
They need
some safety mats up there or something.
All right, let me pull it up.
What are you looking at? Like, Hermas.
His wiener.
Keep looking down.
The iPad.
Oh,
so I can watch the show with you and make fun of Bret Hart. Or were we not doing that tonight?
Yeah, Bret Hart sucks. You hear that, Justin Davis? Bret Hart sucks.
We'll make fun of him the last 5 minutes. I'm not making fun of him for an hour. He didn't deserve all that.
I'm not saying I just didn't.
No, he didn't deserve that exposure.
I'm not saying that I just did this, but did you guys actually click on Jen's OnlyFans?
No.
I didn't see the link.
OnlyFans.
I saw the link. It was like, that's got to be some Saudi Arabian born bullshit.
I'm going to show you her home screen for OnlyFans. Are you ready?
Well, it won't affect me, but go right ahead.
That's my girl right there.
Well done. Well played.
I love that TJ outed himself, though. Like, I'm going to check it. And then I'm going to do it live.
I was going to look up her username so I could actually be like, oh, and also when you're there, search for this person.
And apparently Jen thinks she's Jesus, so that's weird. She said it to me.
Grambling beat Montana State 88-81 in overtime.
Am I rich yet?
No, you don't get paid for the first four. You didn't start till tomorrow's games.
This is the play-ins, dummy.
I think
we didn't even pick the eight games.
Oh, we didn't pick anything for his.
No, not for them.
How do we find out who we have or what we have or how we win?
I sent it out, stupid.
Not to me.
What is your
You're in our group chat.
He is.
Here.
Are you on the Peacock and what is the timestamp?
Timestamp is 1:45, 26, 27, 28. We still have an hour and 3 minutes to go.
I can't wait. I am going to have to pee before this match is over, though.
I do it every time those damn Girl Scouts show up at my house.
You pee on them?
Wow.
You
That's
are
the way I should handle it.
All right, Timmy, open up your text message and let's talk.
I'm open.
This is what we're doing right now. Here's the group chat out loud.
All right, so Timmy C, let me find your one pick.
Yeah, because you tried to get me to buy two. Are you crazy?
I bought five, six.
Well, you're running the damn. All right, here I am. Let's see. I am. I don't even know what any of this means. I'm the top row, the fourth one.
All right, got you. So for the first round, the games that start tomorrow.
Okay.
If the home team finishes with a 9, so if they have 79. And the away team has 0. So say they win 79-70 or 79-80. The other team wins, whatever. You win the $15 for that game.
Okay.
Then in the second round, your home team number is 2-1.
All right. So what do I win?
So for the first round, you win $15 per game.
I've already spent 25.
Usually everybody wins something. So the second round, each game's worth $25.
That's impossible that everyone wins something.
I mean, not
everybody. They lose less.
Right.
Everyone gets a trophy.
So, I mean, the third round. Sweet 16 games are all worth $50. So if you win the game, you win $50. Next round is 100. Final four is 200. And then the championship game, if your numbers hit, you win $420.
I'm gonna win. So
you're gonna run this. This is only one.
How much do you win if you get a clean sweep? Like if every game during the tournament hits your number,
it's a $2,500 pot.
There you go. That's how much I want to win.
You ain't gonna do that. Well, what was your question?
$25 squares is 100 squares. Do the maths.
What was your question, Andrew?
Well, you're not. We're not. We're only. It's for the whole tournament, so your square is only good for the whole tournament.
Your square right. is, but after every round, the numbers change.
Okay, so you're okay. That's
so that way, say you got 0-0, you aren't stuck with 0-0 throughout the entire tournament.
Yeah, for 10 yeah. games or whatever. Gotcha.
Right. Well, it's like 63 games, but
well, I only bought two squares, so you take that times, do the math and all that.
So you have.
I'm going to win Powerball tonight. So
carry the one and all that. Yeah.
Yep. So you can win. You have 126 chances.
Yeah.
Because there's 63 games.
Yep. So I see what Dave is saying, that almost everybody wins something, Tim. Because there's so many games. Until you get
so many numbers.
Last few, yeah.
Don't worry. I keep track of all of it. I have spreadsheets and everything.
Everything we've ever done with Dave, he's on it.
Yeah. So.
So regarding gambling, he's Rain Man. Everything else, fuck it. We're out.
Yeah.
Yeah. I like to gamble.
Dave is a low-key nerd, but it only comes to gambling.
and vacationing.
Yes.
Good news is Elite Eight, I actually have a letter instead of a number, so.
Yeah, you have an R. So if somebody wins 14-7, you win.
14-R.
Hey,
or if Rhode Island makes it to the Final Four.
Is anybody on the topic of this show, and I know you guys, you know, shit on it all week on social, amazed that Vince McMahon would put an hour-long match as his main event on his headline show?
Pat Patterson had to beg the dog shit out of him to do this.
There's no way it just happened. You know what I mean? This wasn't Vince's idea. He had to be sold.
This match should have ended in 20 minutes.
So what? From what
or
I remember,
seven.
What
should have been a 20-minute Iron Man match.
Was you guys shut the fuck up? So what I remember from Something to Wrestle with Bruce Prichard.
Aluminum Man match.
This was the plan going back to whenever, right? Survivor Series or whatever. So, but Pat Patterson was the one that kept wanting to do the Iron Man match going back years, but he never had the right two guys to do it. And when they finally pulled the trigger and went with Brett and Sean, then Pat was like, if any two guys can do it, it's these two.
Right.
So then Pat begged Vince into submission. Actually, Pat came out of retirement for this match to agent it.
I think I would have liked to have seen Yokozuna and Van Vader do an Iron Man match.
We just saw them do eight, and they barely did that.
They stood on the apron the whole time and let Owen and whoever.
That's the real Iron Man. Who doesn't
The Rock and Triple H had a good Iron Man match because it was like 8-8.
I remember that.
Judgment Undertaker's Day 2000.
Return. Yeah.
Judgment Day 2000.
It was like 6-6 or something like that. Here's the best part of this match right here. Super kick to the timekeeper.
I remember watching one.
Well, he's not going to ring the bell anyway. You got 45 minutes to wake his ass up.
I think it was Cena and Orton, and it was like 11-9, which is probably too far in the other direction.
Yeah.
I don't even like 30-minute Iron Man matches. No wrestling match should ever last longer than 16 minutes and 12 seconds.
Well, the Undertaker Diesel match did earlier.
That's as long as it should go.
It went 16-48.
Not a great match, but Kevin Nash was a great character.
I agree.
Yes. I always want to know who the guy was. Look at the front row, and there's a guy with long, dark black hair and sunglasses on. He kind of looks like Howard Stern.
Oh, what is it?
Hard cam?
Yeah.
I think they called him the Howard Stern guy.
He was always at these shows. My little brother and I hated that guy growing up.
Well, TJ hates him now, so.
I think he was an ECW guy also.
He was. He would go to ECW, and he would wear Mick Foley shirts a lot.
As he should. By the way, Mark Eaton dead. Yeah. The ringside. They just showed his carcass, this leg face out on the floor.
Meanwhile,
he doesn't have to wake up for another 43 minutes.
Yeah. Meanwhile, if you turn AEW on tonight, you'll see 86 super kicks, and none of them will get a three count, let alone a dead cell from a ring announcer or timekeeper.
Here we go. They're replaying it.
You know, if they super kick the ring announcer or the timekeeper, and he just sat up like, "What the fuck, man?"
No, he kicked up. He doesn't
kick out.
You hit me right in the face. Oh, is that Tony? That's Tony Chimmel.
Yeah.
That wasn't Eaton.
Well, he didn't slap his leg, so it's not a real super kick.
That's true. Everyone knows the thigh slap gives you like an extra 8 horsepower.
I thought that was Mark Eaton. Sorry,
I think it was Jimmy Kimmel.
I thought that was Mark Eaton. You saying that's Tony Chimmel?
That's Tony Chimmel.
Well, stretcher job. All right, that's the best part of this match.
He's dead. He's literally dead.
Stretcher job for a timekeeper.
A stretcher job for Tony Chimmel.
Right. You're right.
Can we hit the fast forward button?
That's a young Tony Chimmel.
But now that we've talked to Mike Chioda, we know that like Rene Gallet was like, "Don't worry, we won't wait away too far. You got to take the fucking ring apart at the end of the night, okay? Just relax." Jerry Lawler
26. There's still 42 minutes left of this crap.
But I had the closed captioning on, and I just read a sentence. And I'm guessing Jerry Lawler said it. He just asked, "Is this match over yet?"
How do you turn the closed captioning on?
Well, on my Google browser, I believe you go to the little chat box in the left corner, bottom left corner. Should be in there.
Yeah, I'm good. I'm on my Fire Stick. I ain't messing with it.
That's what she said.
I'll end up pausing it or something and then have to watch even longer.
Oh, you should definitely try it then.
So is the heat genuine for Bret Hart, Shawn Michaels?
I can't stand Bret Hart. Never have liked Bret Hart.
Okay.
Shawn Michaels is the greatest in-ring worker of all time.
I think he's a bitter butt wipe as an old man, but I love watching him wrestle.
I thought he was a good wrestler. But I never liked Bret Hart. I never got into him. And I mean, when it was just him and Ric Flair and WCW, I liked Sting. But once Hogan came on, I didn't care about Sting anymore when Hogan went over to WCW.
Sure.
So I didn't care for Sting. And then I was never a big Sting fan. I would have liked to see him go to WWF. I think Sting messed up his whole career by not ever going to WWF till he was 55.
Yeah. Also,
but he looked so cool at the end of that match at Mania 31.
I'm going to be honest with you guys. What with his face paint falling off and his receding hairline?
And his hair is this big.
I'm going to be honest with you guys. When I was, again, I was 11 years old. The day before, I had just turned 11 before this show. I hated Shawn Michaels. pretty much.
Yeah, I even liked Shawn Michaels as a heel. Back when his run was Sherry, I was a big fan.
Well, then I didn't mind him. But this Shawn, and especially DX Shawn, I hated. I didn't like Shawn until he came back in 02.
I hated Born Again Shawn.
I have a thought on Born Again Shawn. And I don't know about you guys, may have a different thought. Without Born Again Shawn, you don't call Shawn Michaels the greatest in-ring performer in wrestling history.
Oh, I agree.
No, because he kept forfeiting titles when he was drunk, Shawn.
Well, when it's obvious he's the best worker in the 90s, that's one thing. But then when you start putting him up against the likes of Triple H or Jericho or RVD or Kurt Angle or The Undertaker in that version of The Undertaker, all of a sudden it's a lot different than what you were seeing in the mid-90s.
Well, there is a longevity aspect to it, right? There's a reason why we don't talk about Blitzkrieg in that conversation. There's a reason why, as much as I love him, there's a reason why we don't talk about Canyon in that same conversation. Canyon was just as good in the ring as anyone else. But these guys did it for 25 years on national television. Canyon didn't. Blitzkrieg lasted, 2 years, maybe?
WCW, yeah.
And they did it at the highest level. Correct. That's the other thing. This is main event versus, no offense to Canyon, mid-card, upper mid-card, you know?
Well, Tommy Rich and Ricky Morton are still doing it here in a couple weekends, so they might make a claim on it.
I just love that we're like best workers of all time. Shawn Michaels, Bret Hart, Timmy's like, Tommy Rich!
I was going to say,
1981!
My good close personal friend, Tommy Rich.
Yeah, you can almost get away with Ricky Morton, but you brought Tommy Rich into it, and that was a favorite.
Wild Bill Irwin is the shit.
Bill Irwin in World Class. Where's Pond Water? Well, Bill Irwin in World Class was legit.
Hey, it takes talent to wrestle in hockey skates.
We need to watch another World Class show.
No, well, our next live, we can do World Class. We got to figure
last
out.
One was so terrible.
Oh, look who's here.
Who's here?
Mark Cyrus.
Oh, Moose is here.
Haven't seen Moose in forever.
Let's see. I'm going to go to our Dropbox and see what we got coming up for the month of May, because there will be a new poll out.
You should probably see April first.
We need to do some old late 80s, early 90s WCW show. I literally bought the WCW package for you guys.
TJ's like, let's see what's going on in September.
Fuck it. We're doing July next month. So let's see. We got upcoming for April. Click over here. 5 shows, 5 weeks in April. How about that? 5 Tuesdays anyway. Saturday night, WCW Saturday night from 1998.
Ooh, I'm out.
Oh, wait, Dave, wait till you hear the next one, buddy. WWWF Old School.
Yeah!
April 1975.
Yes!
That is way too old. I'm not doing that.
Yes, you are!
Hey, Andrew, what are you doing the second week of April? We might need a co-host.
But what are you watching the second week of April?
I can't wait to watch Vern Gagne wrestle George Curious, or whatever his name is.
Curious George.
Also, Vern Gagne never wrestled in the WWF ever. But Dave, I'm gonna make
did I say Vern? I meant Merle Gagne.
Merle Haggard. Dave, I'm going to make it up to you in week 3. You ready for week 3? It's from
better be in the 90s.
It's from 2002. We haven't done this. I think we've only covered one of these shows ever. XPW.
Yeah, remember, O2. We went through all that.
Ooh, Rob Black.
That was one of our best shows, and we did it live. XPW
live. Next show.
Remember, I told you that they did a taping with 26 matches in one day at Universal.
Yeah. I remember when they opened the show with Brian Knobs. I'm like, what are we doing right now? Why is this clown opening the show? And it wasn't even like a match. He was just standing in front of a curtain, like yelling at people. Week 4. Clash of the Champions from April
89. Okay.
Hey, I want to go over this again for any new listeners that are here. The Patreon filter-free network is changing.
It is changing.
It is now going to be the RAM network, wrestling and more. It's going to be sports, pop culture, and entertainment, along with pro wrestling, the RAM network.
I wrote it down in the paper.
Hermes is here with us. He's going to be joining the RAM network with TNA Top 10, along with Terry Weaver, T-Weave.
He'll have a better camera and mic setup.
We also have
still a beautiful house that he's sitting in.
Yeah, the house is beautiful, though.
We also have Talking Wrestling with Pondwater Dave. So Amy, Justin Davis are also in. Yes. The fun director, Justin Yent, will now be part of the Patreon.
Yes.
Allison Fay, the wrestling hair aficionado, is in on the Patreon along with TNA Top 10. She's now a member of that show as their producer.
Mm.
We are going to be bringing a ton of new content to our Patreon, and we want you all to subscribe. For the month of April, we are going to run a special where it is free. No payment for the month of April, and we are going to do a blitz of content for you. And we picked April because WrestleMania 40 is right around the corner, and we want you guys there. We're going to do a lot of interactive shows with people. Anything you can shake a stick at, we're going to be doing. So, obviously, Wrestling with Commercials will be back.
Power of the Pin.
Power of the Pin with TJ. The first episode has already recorded. TJ, who was on Power of the Pin with you last night?
The author of the biography of the Sheik from Detroit, the original Sheik, Brian Solomon, was our guest with me and the Queen of Kentucky, Miss Amy, last night. And it was fantastic.
So lots of content coming. We have about 15, 16 different shows we're going to be doing. Yes, Moose, the first month, April, it is free. We want to see what you guys think. We want to get your, you know, opinions on shows, what shows you like, what shows you don't. We'll rotate from there. We're going to be doing weekly segments on women's wrestling because the fun director, Justin, loves women's wrestling.
Big time.
So he's going to be doing something with women's wrestling. We're going to do weekly recap shows. Monthly shows of what was good, what wasn't. Evolution of Evil will be making a comeback. Yes, it will be on the Patreon. All of our regular podcasts, the Filter Free Podcast, TNA Top 10, Talking Wrestling, all those will be on the video versions live, or not live, but you can watch them as we record them live. Will be on, but we're going to start doing a ton of live shows. We want watch-alongs, everything. We have a lot of people that can create content, and we're going to do it all together. And we're going to give you guys just as much content as we possibly can. So make sure to check out the RAM Network. If you're already following Filter Free Network on Twitter, and it's Twitter at Filter Free Net, the name will be changing. The Patreon name will be changing, but it's the same Patreon. All the content's going to be there from before, and all new content's coming. So join us. We're now at 32-12 in this match left, so they've been going for 28 minutes.
By the way, Bumwine, get in our DMs.
Yeah, Bumwine,
hit us up. Might be able to do some business.
We can figure something out.
I'm not. Let's finish the schedule for April. I'm not done yet because, as everyone who's watching this knows, we are now doing a watch along for one of the shows we cover every month from now until one of us dies, and maybe even longer. So for April, I just said so for this month, we did all the shows, and I kind of knew WrestleMania 12 was going to win, even though Nitro with Flair versus Goldberg was close with 47 minutes of promo.
By the way, that was an underrated show.
It was
with all the damn, there was no wrestling on the show. It would have been trash.
We could have walked right through it.
Wait, you guys have been waiting for an hour and 40 minutes for wrestling, which gets what? We got a match. Yay. Who's in it? Bret Hart versus Van Hammer. You got to be shitting.
Hardcore Hack and Raven with Bam Bam Bigelow running in. There we go.
And no disqualification. It's like, fuck it, triple threat. So I just said Clash of the Champions, April 89. The last week, doubleheader. We're doing WrestleMania 5 from April 89. So
that is probably my favorite WrestleMania of all time. There.
So the poll for April for the watch along is just going to be Clash of the Champions or WrestleMania 5. Those would be your choices for the watch along for April, because quite honestly, if we did a watch along for XPW, it would be 42 minutes long, and that's no fun for anyone.
I'm in.
And I've got some great stories coming up for April. Again, giant dork. I've already got all the topics for all the shows mapped out for March to June.
How the hell am I going to find movies from 1975? Saturday Night Fever.
Fever. I'm not even sure.
We use the whole year.
You're going to, maybe the decade. This movie came out in 1970.
Star Wars and Rambo. That's it. Did Rambo come out in the 70s? That's 80s, 81.
I believe it did.
God, First Blood was like 1980. Five.
Rocky was in the '70s, the first one.
Okay, that, Rocky. That's what I'm.
Rocky was, yeah. Man, I'm looking at some of the shows. So actually, in May, I want to plug one show in May. I'm not going to say what it is, but for those of our hardcores that have been listening to, with us since day one, May is our 3-year anniversary as a show. So in May, what I did was I picked a show we covered way back in the day. It was actually, I believe it was our second episode. And we're going to redo it in the month of May. Because back then, in episode 2.
Beware of Dog?
It was Beware of Dog. In episode Naked. 2, we were the drizzling shits at podcasting. Diana Hart Smith, that's where that whole shit started, was that show.
Yep. Show number 2.
By the way, Dave, another XPW show in May.
I'm in, dude. I used to have the tapes. I gave them to the guy that owns Music City, or what's it called? Music City Toys and Collectibles. I gave him my XPW DVD.
Our longtime close personal friend.
Yeah, good guy. If you need to buy anything, you like wrestling memorabilia, wrestling shirts, wrestling figures, get on Facebook and look up Music City Toys and Collectibles. He's out of Nashville, Tennessee. He'll hook you up. Great stuff.
When Timmy comes back, I'm going to have to go fill up a beer bottle.
Yeah, I got a piece so bad I can taste it.
Yeah, it's bad.
You go. I'll hold down the fort. Go.
All right, I'm going.
Yeah, you got 28 minutes before we see the finish.
Actually, you got about 32.
Yeah, exactly.
Hermes, who's your favorite wrestler of all time?
Arn Anderson.
Arn Anderson, huh?
Macho Man's a close second.
I like Macho Man.
Macho Man got me into wrestling when I was 3 or 4 years old, and I've never looked back. But for the promo, the work, what he meant to the business, it's Arn Anderson.
See, I grew up a Hulkamaniac.
I wasn't a Hogan guy. I was a Macho guy.
But see, now as an adult, I wish Savage would have gotten a win over Hogan.
They were few and far between. He got a lot on the house shows, like by DQ and stuff, but never really a clean win, ever. Because Hulk's Hulk.
Michaels jumps to the outside. You know, these guys got to be gassed as shit 33 minutes in. 27:01, 27 minutes. Time check. We're at 209, 20, 21, 22,
23. Calling some spots right there if you caught that, Dave. The camera got a little close there. They were calling spots, old Michaels and Brett right there. It is a good match if you like wrestling, but like, you know, if you're not interested in seeing something for longer than, like you said, 20 or 30 minutes, it's hard to create something innovative enough that's going to keep someone's attention that long.
See, I just think you could have had this. This could have easily been a 30-minute match tops. They could have put the tag titles on the show instead of on the pre-show. So the finals to that tournament could have been on this show.
Well, and the pacing is so off in this. Because, you know, I mean, I say it's off. They're doing a good job dragging the match out, so to speak. But, I mean, this is an old Jack Briscoe versus Harley Race, you know, kind of tempo. They're going to start picking it up, but they're obviously taking their time, and they know they're going 60, and it's a legit 60. They can't fake the clock in this particular case, you know? You can't. Like they do with the Rumble, you can shave time and all that stuff. There's no shaving time when you put an hour on a scoreboard.
I would have liked to have seen, instead of the six-man tag that opened the show, we talked about this earlier, I would have liked to have seen Yokozuna and Vader. I know Vader was injured. Mm-hmm. He got injured at the Royal Rumble, hence the whole him being suspended by...
Yeah. Well, he came in injured.
Gorilla. Yeah, he came in injured.
Yeah.
But I would have liked to have seen Vader and Yoko get 5 minutes to do something. I mean, you could have made Yoko or Vader over as the monster heel. I would have liked to have seen Bulldog and Ahmed Johnson get a 7-8 minute match in.
I think that would have been a shit show.
To continue, I think Bulldog could have walked him through it. Ahmed Johnson had some decent matches, like with at King of the Ring with Goldust and stuff. He could do it.
But I would have liked to have seen.
What's that?
He had to have the right worker. I mean, you just said Goldust. Goldust, one of the best workers the business had.
Yeah. So, you know, Undertaker and Diesel was good. I would have liked to have seen Razor on this show. Been suspended.
Right.
But he says he never did anything wrong. He was suspended because he told him he was leaving.
Yes.
So.
Well, between the leaving and the homophobia.
Yeah, he didn't want to do the homophobic angle with, or he didn't want to do the. The angle with Goldust.
Checks out that he was in Hogan's stable then.
But you could have easily had three different matches off of that first match instead of the six man. You could have, I mean, even if you just do a tag match and it's Jake and Ahmed Johnson versus Owen and Bulldog, you just could have done something.
Yeah, that six man tag was sad because they wanted to do the Yoko and Vader match. And to your guys' point, Vader gets hurt with the moonsault at Great American Bash, I think, in 95, and he never gets it taken care of. Orndorff whoops his ass, and then he comes to WWF.
Naked.
But Yoko was so
with
heavy.
With a baby arm.
Yeah. It's the shitter net. Sorry, it's catching up. They couldn't move
him. Okay, I got one, too.
Yeah, he couldn't move
him. Right.
Sorry.
I was just going to say, it's actually sad that either Jake or Ahmed were not a heel here at this point, because I think a match Ahmed really could have benefited from was Ahmed versus Jake.
We couldn't have Ahmed as a heel because he had just come in, and they saw dollar signs with him.
They were going to make him champion
because he was over. And yeah, until the kick from Farouk injured him, and then he never ever got healthy again. Every time he came back, he got injured right away.
Remember, he came back during when he joined the Nation. He came back for a run-in.
And injured himself the very first night back.
For a fight with the DOA and, like, tore his quad.
Yeah. Because they were going to push him.
Why he wore the pad on it.
Didn't do shit. Maybe he shouldn't have worn it, maybe. The doctor's like, so you keep tearing your quad because you have these incredibly tiny knee pads just shrink wrapped around your thigh. You need to quit doing that.
You think it would provide support?
Apparently it was not.
Hermes, do you have any cards like Amy has?
No, I don't even know what you guys are talking about.
Come on. Getting to know you. Getting to know all about you.
About you.
What about Cards Against Humanity? You got any of those?
I love Cards Against Humanity.
Now, I can play that game, yeah. I don't have any, but I could play that game.
You're terrible probably at this game.
Probably deserve some of the shit, too.
When I used to own a camper, my wife and I like to go to state parks in the area. As a matter of fact, it's the only place we would go camping in state parks. And we would I would make campfire apple cider. So it was a fifth of Bacardi and a fifth of Captain. And then I would do 2 gallons of apple cider, a gallon of apple juice, 2 cinnamon sticks in a crock pot or in a pot. In a stock
two
pot,
cinnamon, oh, not three. Two no, cinnamon sticks.
Otherwise, 3 overpowers it. So then I put it in a stock pot over the campfire, let it heat up. And it'll get you drunk. And we would watch cards. We would play Cards Against Humanity.
Shocker.
And I've never laughed again. I was shit faced. Let me rephrase that. But I would laugh so hard playing that game.
I have Cards Against Humanity, and I have one better. It's a game called Drawing Without Dignity.
I'm in. I don't even explain the rules. I'm already
It's like adult Pictionary.
Got it.
Oh, God.
I'm in.
Yeah.
Penises. Lots of penises.
You know, like one of the... We played
or
it
mushrooms.
At, we played
mushrooms
it at one of my... we played it at one of my Christmas sweater parties. And one of them was Pearl Necklace.
Oh. So, yeah. I just wrote ZZ Top on the sheet.
Well, my buddy drew a pearl necklace and I got it. So it was
good.
But now, yeah, it way, was
we haven't had a contest with the listeners in quite some time. I mean, it's probably been close to a year since we've done box score trivia. And if you guys remember, we had an autographed poster from NXT. Oh, what show was that?
It was Stand and Deliver.
It was TakeOver. It wasn't Stand and Deliver. Charlotte was on it. That's how long ago it was. Rhea Ripley was on it. But it was autographed by all the people on the poster but two. And I don't remember what two it was. But that was our last giveaway in the last top Boxwork trivia. A poster I bought at WrestleCade last year. So I think we need to get ready to do that again. That was fun. We haven't done something like that in quite some time. We've never done a Timmy's Trivioki or a Have You Seen Tit trivia game with the listeners.
Yeah, I would totally do music against people.
But if you're not going to sing, I'm just going to warn the listeners now, if you're not going to sing when you find out the song, don't bother signing
yeah,
up.
Yeah, don't. It also is a talent show. So if I sing it better, right. You lose.
We will give you a record contract if you win. It ain't going to be worth a shit, but we'll give you one. We will pay you in creamed corn.
Oh, why did you pick the worst vegetable on the planet? Gross.
It's not even out of vegetable. It's a starch.
What?
Well, it comes in a can. It's creamy. It's gross.
Sean Jones, you're wrong. I would love to hear you sing.
And your picture is stupid.
In fact, I demand it. By the way, we should mention as we have 17 minutes and change to go left in this match.
By the way, is this Iowa football we're watching? 0-0?
Yes. This is our highest viewed show ever.
Well, it's been going on for 42 days.
I mean, yeah, I mean, I guess just from attrition standpoint, we were bound to break a record, but thank you to everyone tuning in tonight. Moose no sing, moose no balls. That's what I say. Sing, bitch. Don't be shy.
He's got a great speaking voice too, so you know he's got it in him, TJ. Don't let him
be fair. Moose has balls. He just hasn't seen him in years.
He can bust out some Barry White. Don't bullshit me. James Otto, come on, man. I know you can do it. I remember him. What was it? First Top Guy weekend, Sting walked in and Moose just walked around and go, fuck!
The good news is they're going to start picking up the pace. The bad news is they got 16 and a half left.
So that is the issue with an Ironman match is... I mean, they're going at a good speed now. The first 25 minutes,
yeah,
not so much. And I mean, I get it. I understand why.
Yeah, because you're going to go. That's what we were talking about when you had to go fill a beer bottle, as you called it earlier.
Yes.
At some point, you can't cheat the clock. You know, when you put an hour on a scoreboard in an arena, you can't cheat the clock. So you've got to be able to go. Now these two, you know. Probably the best candidates in 1996 for an Ironman match.
He may have just murdered Jose Lothario.
And what a badass Jose is, if you know anything about Texas wrestling. You know,
we've seen him on some of the old World Class shows.
Yeah, and that was toward the end of his career. Yeah. Honestly, you know, that wasn't even during the heyday. But if you've watched the stuff with him and Gino, I mean, they lit the territory on fire.
God, they're beating the shit out of Jose. So I think I don't know if we've seen a world-class show yet with Gino.
I don't think we have.
I don't think we have.
I think we've seen Von the Freebirds.
Von Water's the expert, but the Von Erichs took on, we did this for the Jake the Snake podcast I helped Marcus with. Chris Adams had turned on the Von Erichs.
Yes.
And so it was the Von Erichs versus Jake, Gino, and Adams.
Yeah.
So pretty good six-man tag, and they actually beat the Von Erichs for the six-man tag title.
It's a pretty eclectic six-man group.
Yeah, and then they were trying to get, I believe it was Mike over, so Jake ate like five pins in a row on major events like the Star Wars and such, and then he ended up going, he left WCCW because he couldn't make any money, and he went back to Watts. But
where he wore his karate pants.
Yes. Yeah. One of the worst things I've ever seen is Mike Von Erich doing the press conference just before they did their Israel show after he was recovering. No, I'm sorry. It was after the Israel show where he got toxic shock syndrome. And he did that press conference. I think they were setting up for the Texas Stadium show. And it's terrible. I cannot believe
14 minutes remaining in the match.
I cannot believe Fritz Von Erich let his son go up there like that and do a press conference like that. He was in such bad shape.
Mm. Yeah, and that, I mean, I did get a lot of press because of the movie, but it really is a tragic story.
Of course.
Because Fritz buried a baby too, and I think that was
Jack.
There was four of them. If not five,
there's five.
Yeah, not.
So it was Jack, yet. David, Kevin, Carrie. No, there was six. Mike.
Yeah, five died.
That's what I meant. Five of the six died. Yeah. At some point, you have to stop counting. That's the sad part, you know. And there's only so much tragedy someone's going to take.
Kevin's still kicking in Hawaii. I couldn't be happier for him. And the Jack Jr. one was so bizarre because they were living at the time. Fritz was working out of Buffalo. So they lived in a mobile home park and it was snowing because it's Buffalo. And they dropped Jack. I always catch myself saying this because my son's name's Jack. They were dropping off Jack. You can't say dropping Jack off. Dropping off Jack. And he was walking around the trailer and he touched the trailer hitch on the front of the trailer and it electrocuted it. Or not electrocuted because electrocution's dead. I'm an electrician. So he shocked him. And then he fell face down in the snow and drowned.
That's how he died. Out of that happiness, Miss Amy is helping us from the beyond.
Is she also dead?
No, but beyond this show, asked her to send me pictures of the cards.
And I got a card one. All I saw was a nipple.
Would you say you are faster or more flexible?
Neither.
Oh, faster.
Got to be faster because I'm fat.
You remember in high school when you had to do the V?
Hermes is like. Well, let's see. Last Saturday night,
I'm doing the math. Yeah,
you're in high school. You're
probably flexible. I am a cardio machine, but I'm probably flexible, not fast.
He had ribs removed. He said just for flexibility.
I am most definitely faster.
Hey, Dave, you've met me in real life. We're gonna have to do a lot more than removing ribs at this point. Okay.
You were in high school. You had to do the V sit and reach. For like your physical fitness test, I had to have people put feet on my shoulders just to get me back to zero. So whatever the baseline is for fast, I'm way more fast than I am.
So card number two, do you have any special skills or talents when it comes to crafting or DIY projects?
I have a special talent. Watch this.
Special talent when it comes to DIY. I built this room. I framed it up, drywall, insulated and drywalled it.
I had a pretty sick bar at my old house. Remember? I built that.
I do remember that.
I'm buying one now and having it delivered because I don't want to build another one.
That makes complete sense.
I'm a walking stereotype, landscaping and gardening.
Nice.
Some of you will catch that in 20 minutes.
What's your go-to plant?
Hydrangeas.
Good. You can come to my house because my wife sucks at it. She does not have a green thumb, and we need some fucking plants.
This year, I am clearing my shit out and just putting gravel. Like, river rock everywhere. And like, I'll buy some stone things and put in there. I don't want to try anymore.
I'm the guy, I could landscape, I'd give two shits. But I think this year in the backyard, because I'm thinking about selling the house this year and getting a bigger one. So I'm thinking about the backyard, investing in the rollout sod. Thinking about doing that this year.
That's not a special skill or talent.
I didn't say it was.
Investing.
I just want you to know what's going on in my life. That's all.
I'm investing.
Next card. Grass. If you could have Dave, any if anyone should be appreciated, what would it be?
Grass should be you.
Say it again.
If you could have any superpower, what would it be? We already did this, Dave.
We did? I didn't do this.
Yeah. I thought we did this.
Uh-uh. I don't think so.
Okay.
Any
TJ, you didn't listen.
I don't most of the time you're talking.
I think being able to fly would be pretty kick-ass. Be able to read kids or people's minds.
I really thought Dave was going to go with X-ray vision. Just saying.
Or X-ray vision so I can see titties.
Special powers.
Oh, look, Stacy Keebler.
Motorboat.
I can't walk. I'm so exhausted from all the
magic. That'd be the worst of the motorboats, by the way.
I think that. Man, that's tough.
Yeah,
I think Spider-Man. I gotta go Spider-Man.
I'd like to have Batman's power, just be super rich.
It's not really a power.
You already are.
Yeah. With a growly voice.
It's not a superpower, it's an acquired skill.
I'm gonna go with flying. Yeah.
Being able to fly.
You know how much money you could save being able to fly?
I mean, it'd be cool to shoot shit out of your eyes or use the Wolverine blades, but flying is much more functional. It actually has something you do.
It'd be a nice revenge tactic for you if you could shoot shit out of
your
eyes.
Having like Professor X's thing and being able to like control her mind, that'd be pretty cool. Stacy Keebler.
You wouldn't need X-ray vision because they just take their shirts off.
Dave would have the quagmire arm.
Yeah. No, I wouldn't. I wouldn't need it.
Dave, I haven't seen you in a week. Where you been? I just had to go with that. I have to go back inside.
Amy underestimated the length of this match. She only sent us three.
Yeah, bro, what are you doing?
We need like 7:56
to go. Oh, Lord.
As much
Iowa still hasn't scored.
As much as I enjoy having legitimate wrestling conversations, we've done that twice during this match. I'm out of shit to talk about. You guys want to talk about Stampede wrestling in the 70s and the 80s? Bastion Booger was really good in Canada. He was Makan Singh.
Yeah, and then they made him.
What was he in WCW? Norman.
Norman the Lunatic, the Mad Monk, Friar Ferguson, Bastion Booger.
I told you guys this. But I watched a Monday Night Raw once where the main event was. So you remember Bastion Booger was feuding with Bam Bam over Luna? Mm-hmm. So there was a main event on Raw one night. It was the Smoking Guns against Bam Bam Bigelow and Bastion Booger. So if you think about it, the main event was Bart and Billy Gunn against Bastion Booger and Bam Bam Bigelow. There were 7 fucking B-names.
A lot of bees.
In one match.
I bet you Vince.
The rumble over the Better Business Bureau.
How did WWF make it through 93?
1987.
I go back and watch all the Raws in order. 94 with some very few examples. strictly because of the flooding of shit gimmicks. 94 is far worse than 93. 94 might be the worst year for WWF ever.
What about 95, though? Because they weren't that good either.
Well, 95, you started to see some guys emerge. And what I meant by shining examples of 94, right? You had Bret and Owen at 10. You had July was, in my estimation, the greatest television title defense ever. That was Bret Hart, 1-2-3 Kid in July on Raw. And part of that, a big part of that was Jim Ross called it. And then you got Shawn and Razor 2 at SummerSlam that year. And then I actually enjoyed the Bob Backlund Bret Hart match at Survivor Series. I didn't hate it. That was okay.
Too long.
It was a little long.
94 too. It was Razor and Diesel at SummerSlam. Next year it was Michael.
Yeah, 95. See, I remember like that SummerSlam was in Chicago, and I was stoked for it. For that, I ate that Undertaker versus Undertaker thing up, dude.
They brought Walter Payton out here. Yeah.
Frank Bruno has that poster of SummerSlam with the two Undertakers facing in each other. In the
broken mirror.
Autographed.
That's awesome.
He's got an autograph by Undertaker and Brian Lee.
And Brian Lee, yeah.
I liked that. I thought that was a good pay-per-view.
Well, again, in 94, I'm 9. I was all the way in.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I was in 94. It's like summer of 94. I was 12. I was all over this shit, dude. I loved it.
Well, and on the other channel, you're seeing Hulk Hogan wrestle Ric Flair and the Masked Man come out and bust his knee and all the other stuff. So I
remember watching that live on Clash of the Champions.
The Butcher. Yeah, you butchered a friendship. They had to have something to counterbalance Hulk. So you do Taker versus Faker. And of course, that summer, Vince came off the steroid trial. So maybe 94 was so horrible because, you know, him and Jerry McDivitt are trying to save his ass. Because that was as close as the federal government had ever gotten to getting Vince McMahon.
Right.
Really, too bad they didn't.
Yeah, and in retrospect.
Yeah, clearly. And I'm not saying they won't get him with what this new stuff is.
Oh, they're going to.
But.
They're going to. But could you imagine an Attitude Era WWF run by Jerry Jarrett?
Huh? No,
wouldn't have happened.
We would have had Jeff Jarrett as our champion the whole time.
WCW would have been the one.
10 years of Jeff Jarrett.
WWF goes under in 99, because that's what would have happened. WCW probably still doesn't make it just because of the merger. You have no major wrestling companies after 2001 in the United States.
Yeah, because ECW folds when WWF goes under.
Yeah, so you have that's a good point. They go under the same time. So you have.
So now we'd just be stuck with AEW wanting to kill ourselves.
But or do we?
But none of the stars. Because
I actually think it would have been better for wrestling today had wrestling gone dark in 99. Because this same shit happened in the 40s when the New York Times ran a revealing piece called Wrestling a Work. Well, Madison Square Garden didn't show wrestling for like 25 years after that. They came back. Some guy named Bruno Sammartino lit the region on fire. And here we are. So maybe it would have been good if wrestling would have gone dark in 2000.
Well, the 2000s were not good either.
No, they weren't.
So like well, you go back and watch
be fair,
it.
There's a few more entertainment possibilities in 2000 than there was in 1940.
It's true. But I stopped watching. So I went to WrestleMania 19 in Seattle. Went there. I didn't watch wrestling again after that show until 2007.
And I mean, 2007, there would have been something popped up like XPW or whatever. That would have been the new one. And it would have been like WCW Lite, but they would have made it work because Hogan probably would have funded a lot of it.
Oh, sure. Well, one of them would have, yeah.
The shit of it all is that the guy that basically provided all this for us is the world's worst person.
Oh, absolutely.
Because, yeah. Without him, we've met all these wrestlers and promoters and they're all trash. while Vince McMahon is trash of a different sort, he's good at business.
I mean, I kind of like Eric Bischoff.
Also not great at business.
Also different when WCW goes under, Eric Bischoff probably buys it.
Yeah, he's a legacy protector. Everything was not his idea as long as it was a failure. And it's okay 25 years later to admit something wasn't a good idea. Like fucking up the biggest main event your company ever had.
Dude. I can't believe he's still dying on that hill.
He is, and that's the thing. It's like, just admit it. 1997 was 27 years ago. Just admit, y'all, let Hulk do what Hulk wanted to do, and you fucked up your payoff.
He wasn't tan enough. Did you see his face?
Here's my thing, TJ, and you're a guy, obviously, you know, wrestling historian. I write the orange shows. These are things observant people do. Y'all watch wrestling every fucking week. Sting was at every single WCW Nitro, and you decide the night you're going to make him and put him over Hogan that he's not ready?
It's a giant flaw in the story, right? Yeah. Giant flaw in the story.
He's there every single week rappelling from the ceiling, and all of a sudden, not ready. Not ready.
Well, I mean, Hogan beat him. That wasn't a slow count.
Hogan threw the flag. Not going to work. Doesn't work for me, brother.
And then they come back in Super Brawl, and it makes it so much less than when they get it they get it right, you know.
Well, they did it on Nitro too, and then Super Brawl.
So we just had this count. We actually covered Super Brawl 7 last month, and Dave and I got into a quasi argument. As much as we can argue, Dave and I are too much alike. But I thought, and I still believe to this day, Roddy Piper should have won the world title at Super Brawl 7. Coming out of Alcatraz. No one was ever, with the exception of Sting in 97, that's the only babyface that ever got that over against Hogan, was Piper.
Goldberg.
He should have won the world title. For one, two purposes, right? You actually add some intrigue because Hogan's not dominating WCW, but also you give Piper his one thank you world title reign.
I could have seen them giving Piper the belt at Starrcade 96 and then Hogan winning it back at Sold Out. I could have seen that. Because Piper went over Hogan every time they wrestled when the belt wasn't on the line.
Right.
Because just randomly, it wasn't on the line at 96 when it was, but then it wasn't.
Well, and they deliberately didn't announce it was a title match, and they didn't make a big deal about it, that it not being a non-title match. So when he puts him to sleep at the end of the show, you think Piper won the title, but he didn't. Yep.
And then we watched that show for whatever reason, Super Bowl, they restart the match after Piper put him to sleep. And then who came out? Was it Savage?
Macho Man.
It was Macho Man because he was a free agent. Yeah. And for those of you playing along at home, we are in overtime now. Dave and Timmy's favorite. We've gone more than 60 minutes in this Iron Man match.
Enjoying it now because.
Shawn Michaels is looking like Shawn Michaels. Super kick. The first super kick just hit.
So I'm gonna level with you guys. I hated Shawn Michaels here. Well, again, like I said, pretty much his whole first run, I hated him. I hated that he strip teased. I just hated him altogether.
Yeah, it's but terrible loved being his, a sexy boy. Yeah.
I loved his second act. But I will not deny. The fucking guy could wrestle.
DX Shawn was the best.
I hated DX Shawn too.
Well, that was pilled out of your mind, Shawn, you know, and so whatever he thought of came out of his mouth or went on the screen at the time.
What's crazy is how good pilled out Michaels was in the ring, though.
Absolutely. He said and did shit that I thought was great. Don't get me wrong, from time to time. But I still thought DX 2 was better than the original.
1, 2, 3. Now Brett gets all boo-boo.
Boyhood dream has come true.
The boyhood dream. Here comes Vince freaking out. Yeah.
So.
Brett gets mad because he was a transitional champion. Like every champion isn't a transitional champion.
That's true.
They got to lose it to somebody at some point.
So there's been two champions that were not transitional in the history. Well, actually now three. In the history of the company. Four. It's Bruno. Bob Backlund. Hogan, Roman.
Yeah.
That's it. Even Austin. I think Austin's longest run was 4 months.
Like, Macho had a full year.
He did. And that's actually probably the best year WWF ever had.
But he had the full year, but I mean, the whole point of it was to drop it to Hogan the next year.
Yeah.
So, I mean, but it's just to say, like, Brett was mad. He won the belt from Diesel, but everything was being built around Shawn Michaels beating him at WrestleMania. But it's like, dude, okay, well, what about the year before when everything was around you beating Yokozuna at WrestleMania, dickface?
Yeah.
Like, what difference does it make?
So,
by the way, why is Brett hanging around? Like, they're presenting the title to Shawn, and Brett's just like, I'm going to meander
so around. So, it's the interesting you said, literally the last sentence of the write-up in the Wrestling Observer is, Brett walked out of the ring at the finish rather than doing a symbolic in-ring passing of the torch. Guess on the star rating. We just watched an all hour and 2 minutes of it.
Two. 7 3/4.
3 3/4.
It was like 4. Do you have
a realistic guess? Because you know it's not 7 1/4.
4 1/4.
4.5.
It was 4 1/4 stars. I'm not going to read you the whole thing because it's like 8 pages and it's sticky, but it's long.
What? Sticky.
What happened? So again, at this show, so say what you will about the Iron Man match. It's forever, we will grant you, but it was all in all a decent enough match. WCW's answer to this on pay-per-view that same month is the Doomsday Cage between Hogan and Savage, and
also entertaining. And by the way, I would have loved to have done that watch along
for all the wrong reasons. Every heel
in the company, yeah, every heel in the company. They brought Zeus back for that.
Well, even the Gangsta,
the Gangsta.
I just listened to the What Happened When they watched that show with Tony Schiavone, and forget the goofy ass cage structure, forget the scaffolding on the outside they were walking around for what a dumbass reason, and if one of them slipped, they would have died. The first two guys they face, Ric Flair and Arn Anderson, you literally saved the shit people for last. And Brian Pillman's in that match. I don't remember that at all. I think he just hung out in the back.
Yeah, he never makes an appearance. He's not in the match.
I thought he was announced to be.
He was supposed to be in the match, but he got boo-boo faced. That's when he's starting to do his swerve between the two. Yeah, to doing the contract loose cannon. And Hogan wanted him in, but wanted to pin him or something. And Pillman wouldn't do the job. And so they ended up...
Why don't you pin Tiny Lesser?
And he might have come in at the end. You might be right, TJ. But he did not start the match. He did not start that match, though. Yeah, because they talked about that on, I think they talked about it on 83 Weeks, and I've heard Kevin Sullivan talk about it before too, where Pillman really was the loose cannon because nobody had any idea what the hell he was going to do from day to day. And then he got in the car wreck and it ruined it all.
Right. So we have 4 minutes to go on this show. Do you guys have any send off thoughts before we close this up?
Take us home, please.
Okay. Well, again, I remind you guys.
Nobody wants to watch Sean Bowes.
There will be a poll out here in the next few days, right after this show drops. Next month, April, your two choices for the poll, WCW Clash of the Champions from April 89 or WrestleMania 5. Those are going to be your two choices for the poll. What is wrong with WrestleMania 5?
All right. No one wants to watch us for 3 hours.
They literally just did it. It's our highest viewed show ever. We're beautiful people.
Compilers. We're compilers.
You know what? I like that.
Like Nolan Ryan, right, Tim?
WrestleMania 5, let's do it live.
Yeah, Dave's voting WrestleMania 5 because Demolition.
I'm voting WrestleMania 5.
Let me see what the main event of Clash of the Champions was, because I don't remember off the top of my head.
Same weekend?
It's Flair, Steamboat, Flair. In Louisiana in front of 1,000 people, if I'm not mistaken.
No way. It's a Superdome?
They put it in the Superdome, I think, because it goes February, April, and May. They closed the program down.
You can
double check me, TJ. That's Flair and Steamboat.
It is... Oh, it went to the. I don't want. Oh, here we go. Dates and venues. 89, April 89, Clash of the Champions 6, Raging Cajun, Superdome. But apparently the main event is Lex Luger versus Jack Victory.
I'm in. I want that. Title?
That can't
I
be
want
right.
it.
No, it's a 2 out of 3 falls match, if I'm not mistaken.
I know it's not Lex Luger versus Jack Victory. I know it's not.
Please, please make give me
no,
that
I believe so. I believe you're right. I think that is Flair and Steamboat in the Superdome in front of 5,300 people, if I remember correctly.
I thought it was like 1,000. Like legitimately, they did not do anything for themselves to sell that show.
Andrew, tell us the name of your show.
TNA Top 10. Every week we drop on Tuesday, kind of like these guys. Terry and I right now are in our quote off season, where we're ranking the most obnoxiously obscure things from sitcoms to Serial. Next time we're doing sitcoms Terry didn't think of. And then we're going to do.
Because he forgot all of them.
Yeah, he did. Hey, we made the list tonight. That's what I was doing before I got here. But we're trying to be more of a quote variety show because we felt like breaking down football plays for 2 and 3 hours at a time was probably boring some people. So we're trying to do less of that and be, you know, a little more variety, I guess. I said variety, but not just football-centric where we talk about the Iron Bowl for 45 minutes and one play for 30 of those 45 minutes. So
there you go.
Like I say, we're on social. Terry does a good job. keeping me straight, if that's it at all possible.
There's no way you've ever been straight.
That is the absolute truth. absolute truth. I have some really fun ideas for TNA's top 10 things, and Terry keeps Xing them because he doesn't know anything about fashion or this type of music or this. I said, Terry, they're stilettos. He said, I don't give a shit. I don't know anything about them. So
I would like to see Terry talk about stilettos.
I would like to see Terry wear stilettos.
It would be hilarious, but he keeps vetoing my ideas. So
I would rather see him in hooker boots.
I don't know if he could manage him, but it would be fun to watch, even if it was for 5 minutes. But no, I appreciate y'all having me on. You know, we're going to, like you all said, we're going to do some more collaborating. I really have an idea for me and Dave. It would be a one-time show, probably. But it would be revisiting Florida State versus Nebraska, Osborne, Bowden. My bad.
Osborne and Bowden.
Bowden. But the Orange Bowl always ran through the Big Eight, and it ran through Florida State for the most part, if it won't Miami. So
we can do the year before, too. Florida State and Nebraska played in that one, too.
They played in 93. They played in 92. They played in 89, maybe, or 90.
All 7 viewers would love that.
Yeah, I live 46 minutes from Notre Dame.
Place
the shithole.
Congrats.
Touchdown, Jesus.
Jesus don't watch football.
You and Lou
That's
Holt.
Not true. He does.
He's from Israel. He watches soccer.
But like I said, you know, there's stuff like that we talked about doing. We talked about profiling the Miami team from 01 because if you look at that roster, absolutely ridiculous.
You know who they lost to?
O-H-I-O.
You could watch. We could watch the game, Tim. And
we
could, I'm putting.
Yeah, the bullshit ending of that game.
And we could
talk about Maurice Claret and how he turned into.
We should do a 2013 Florida State show. Where every single player on the starting offense and starting defense was drafted into the NFL.
This is my point. See, that's why we like the collaboration because we go in away from it, and you guys have a lot of fun. I will say this. This show is highly entertaining, and so I was glad to be able to be part of it, even if Tim's a clown.
He's the clown.
Ice cream machine working or not.
It's not.
We're going to do a Kelsey's Only show.
Well, that could work, too.
From University of Cincinnati.
Bonus content.
Jason Kelsey,
approved.
Travis Kelsey. We'll talk about Taylor Swift.
Kelsey's nuts. We need to have a bonus show where Timmy proves that his fucking shake machine works.
That's what, yeah, because he's the only
bonus content
in America.
We'll send Amy over to that McDonald's to get a swirl cone.
No, her daughter, because apparently she's talking to him. So the whole show is just Timmy going.
By the way, her daughter's there like 3 days a week.
Till it breaks.
Yeah. Oh.
But it never breaks, remember? That's what he keeps telling us.
We don't have that. Horse we don't have that problem.
Anyway. But, Timmy, what is the Twitter handle of your shake machine?
At TimmyC1979.
Dollar Bill Dave.
Follow me on X.
Stop it.
Or Twitter.
At Dave in the HSV.
And I'm at TSteve91. Of course, we are on Twitter at FF Popcast. On Instagram at Filter Free Popcast. Next week, we're going to cover WCW Saturday Night from April of 1998. We're going to kick off the NFL Europe. We get to talk about the NFL draft, too, which
World
excites
League?
To me. Huh?
World League?
NFL Europe.
World
that's
Star.
That's what it was first.
We're also going to rock out for the rainforest and so much more. This has been the Filter Free Podcast, and so long for now.
Joke of the week. What's a rabbit's favorite type of music? Hip hop.
It was too easy. It was too obvious.
Damn.